Getting a little heated inside the palace here in Norman, Oklahoma and Baylor. Both of these teams ready to rock in Norman. Baylor looking to beat Oklahoma in back-to-back years for only the second time ever. Kickoff moments away, and this game could have some implications when it comes to the Big 12 standings. We're excited to be with you, Courtney Lyle, alongside Washington State All-American NFL quarterback Ryan Leaf, and taking a look at both of these teams. I mean, for this Baylor program, they won the Big 12 last year, and they're starting to play some really good football at the right time.
Yeah, they're definitely the right time for them. If they keep on winning, they have a chance still at the Big 12 title. A little more dire for the Oklahoma Sooners, but they've been playing extremely well with Dylan Gabriel back.
Yeah, absolutely, and Oklahoma's head coach Brent Venables is standing by with our Tori Petrie.
Thanks, Courtney. Coach, two teams really coming on at the same time. Where is this one going to be won and lost today?
Yeah, it's an easy one. It's going to be won in the trenches today. You know, they want to run the football. We've got to be efficient at running the football. They play a physical brand. We want to be a physical brand. Between that and the kicking game, the wind's blowing pretty good today. I think the kicking game will be the hidden yardage all day today.
Thank you so much, Coach Courtney.
Brent Venables really glad to have Dylan Gabriel back. He makes them go, and it's obvious the difference that he makes when he's starting a quarterback for the Sooners.
Well, it's been the real difference. Without him on the football field, they've been a different team. And his ability to not only take this team down the football field, but not turn it over. Only one interception to this season. He gets hurt in that TCU game after the quick loss to Kansas State, where they were right in it until the very end of the game. His down-the-field passing with Marvin Mims, his ability to run the football when asked, his accuracy down the field, that's what makes him so much more important to this football team and really is the straw that stirs the drink.
And for Baylor, it makes a difference, too, when Blake Shapen is in. He's coming off maybe his most confident, complete performance last week.
He probably didn't turn the football over, which has been a big problem for him this year. His ability to run this offense in which they run the ball first, right? Play action pass with it after that. And he's just turned the ball over too much, especially on the ground with the fumbling. When you throw the ball through the air and you get interceptions as a quarterback, that's going to happen. But you got to take better care of the ball when you're inside the pocket, when you're using the ball handling in your play action.
A great crowd on hand inside Oklahoma Memorial Stadium. Oklahoma is going to receive the kick. Baylor won the toss. They deferred, so they will get it in the second half. Baylor has only beaten Oklahoma in back-to-back seasons one time. It came in 2013, 2014. They're trying to do it again today.
They have every chance. They're playing as good as they have been all year long, and it's going to be 60 minutes of just battle.
Noah Rauschenberg with the kickoff for the Baylor Bears and boots it out of the end zone. So for the first time today, we will get to see Dylan Gabriel go to work. Started out at UCF. He has come over with someone he knows very well, Jeff Lebby, who's their offensive coordinator. And what do you like most about Dylan Gabriel, especially what you've seen recently?
He's just in full control of the offense. He understands it immensely. He knows where to go with the football when he's in trouble. As you can see, only one interception on the season so far compared to the 14 touchdowns, almost 65% completion percentage. He is going to be the reason why this football team wins if he has a big game.
Immediately handed off to Braden Willis, the do-it-all tight end, one of the main leaders for this Oklahoma group, and he takes it to the 31-yard line. Tackled by Gabe Hall. We may call his name a lot. Gabe Hall is definitely an impact player for Baylor.
Yeah, player of the week last week in the Big 12. Has underperformed, according to Dave Aranda this season, but expects a lot from him.
Quick toss out is their motion guy. Excuse me, that is Drake Stoops, number 12 in crimson, and he was stopped by Lorando Johnson.
Yeah, Lorando Johnson he identifies immediately and then just goes. And it's been difficult to get Stoops down to the ground when they're on the perimeter. He does for a tackle for loss.
Yeah, he's a guy that they trust big time. Talking about Drake Stoops, they trust him in multiple situations. Gray was running out of the backfield. Dylan Gabriel's going to go over the top, got the first down, and going to midfield is Braden Willis before he's met by Matt Jones. A 19-yard pickup. They're using Braden Willis already. Two touches in this game on this first drive. Off play action. Gabriel with time, but now he's flushed and plenty of field in front of him. Inside the 30, steps out about the 25-yard line. A 25-yard gain.
That's the different variable that Dylan Gabriel brings. Go straight man coverage across the board. No one is identifying with Dylan Gabriel. He notices it. He takes off, and all there is green grass. Doesn't take a hit, steps out of bounds, and picks up a huge first down.
Gabriel still working with Eric Gray back there. Marvin Mims, their top receiver, is at the top of your screen. They'll send him in motion. And the handoff to Gray. Swung down at the line of scrimmage. No gain on the play. Garmin Randolph, who plays their jack position.
That's a great call there. Watch him just stay put. Doesn't move and then uses his body to make a sure tackle in space. It's one of the most difficult things now in college football is tackling in space because they just don't have the opportunities in practice.
And flag's coming out.
False start. Number three, offense. 5-yard penalty. Still second down.
Kevin Boitman is our referee today.
A.J. McCarty there, starting at right corner for the Baylor Bears. He kind of acted like he was coming on a corner cat, and that got Jahlil Farouk to kind of jump and get the offsides.
Off play action. Gabriel will go ahead and dump it to Eric Gray. Trying to cut back inside. What a move. He certainly is shifty. A yard short of the first down, though. Takes it to the 16.
That's exactly what I was talking about, Courtney, just to play before. Watch him in space here. He makes a miss. And I mean, Dylan Doyle's about as good as you get, and he still makes a miss and almost picks the first down up.
They go back to Eric Gray. He's got that first down to the 11. His birthday yesterday, started his college career at Tennessee before becoming an Oklahoma Sooner.
Big game for Tennessee today, right? You wouldn't know about that.
No, I've never heard anything about it. They stick to the ground game. It's got to be scary for a defense just watching Eric Gray because he
can. The runner's forward progress was stopped before the ball came loose. Second down.
He can cut and shift in so many different ways.
No, he does a good job when he's parallel, when his shoulders are parallel to the line of scrimmage. But what Baylor does so well is their defensive line is big and physical, and they're disciplined. They hit the gaps they're supposed to. They're not out of position. So even if a guy's shifty like that, you know, he's not going to be able to go anywhere when everybody's in the right spot.
Heard Brent Venables tell Torrey how important the lines of scrimmage both sides would be today, and that pass incomplete. Intended for Braden Willis, the tight end, Al Walcott in coverage.
Good pump fake out here to the left, kind of pulls the linebacker, but it's man coverage, and, you know, Braden Willis just it didn't look like he saw it, and Dylan Gabriel got that on him pretty darn quick, though it was good coverage on the back end.
So it's going to be 3rd and 9 from the Baylor 10-yard line. This time the back is Marcus Major. Gabriel running it himself. Inside the pylon, Dylan Gabriel.
What a run. I mean, he absolutely made a Baylor defender miss right around the 5-yard line and then steps into the end zone himself. It did not look from up here like he was going to score. Didn't look like he had the speed. Watch as he moves to the outside here. He makes number 4 miss. That you cannot have. Use the sideline as your perimeter right there. Make sure as a boundary he can't get more to your left. Funnel him back to the middle of the field. He doesn't do that, and he scores the touchdown.
You know, there were questions. Was Dylan Gabriel okay using his legs after the hit he took against TCU? I think he looks okay. He ran a couple of times on that drive.
I tell you what, you know, after having your bell run, you're a football player. You just... Dylan Gabriel makes the move in the open field, steps into the end zone.
Go and get rewarded for it. Save up to 25 cents per gallon of gas with the MyPhillips 66 app. That's right, up to 25 cents per gallon of gas. That means for every fill up, you're saving money for your next adventure. That's a reward that keeps on going. The app is safe and secure. Plus, mobile pay offers fewer touch points during payment, so you can focus on going and saving. Download and start saving with the My Philips 66 app, so you can save more to go more. Philips 66. Live to the full.
This is what you've trained for. Sun up to sun down. And at the end of the day, all that hard work pays off.
Touchdown.
Because when you put forth the effort, the drive, the dedication, you become unstoppable. And that, my friends, is what it's all about. Landers Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram of Norman is driven to serve.
For over 60 years, Mathis Brothers has proudly served Oklahoma with the largest furniture selection at the lowest prices every day. Now we're changing to serve you better. Introducing Mathis Home, a proud sponsor of Oklahoma Athletics. Honored to carry on a tradition of excellence in partnership with the University of Oklahoma. We're committed to providing the best shopping experience and the best value to every customer. Come see why we're your furniture leader at Mathis Home.
The best place to stay hot this November is at Riverwind.
With so many ways to win on over 2,800 of your favorite games.
With some of the best dining and drink options around.
It's easy to see why we're OKC's number one casino.
It's time to come to Riverwind.
Dylan Gabriel punches it in on a 10-yard run and puts Oklahoma on the board first. 10 plays, 75 yards. He was 3-for-4 and through the air on that opening drive.
Yeah, he was really impressive, not only with his arm, but with his feet. Something that you talked about, a little weary on whether he was going to carry the ball down the field after taking that big hit against TCU, but he looked optimal. And when Jeff Lebby scripts his first drive and first 10 or so plays, you know, you're really locked in with those, and that's usually where you see the most success in this style of offense and with Dylan Gabriel.
And Dylan Gabriel and Jeff Lebby know each other so well, spent time together at UCF, have a great relationship, so that has really helped the development of this Oklahoma offense. Neighbors is the one to bring it out for Baylor. Past the 30 he goes. Two Oklahoma Sooners finally take him down just over the 35-yard line.
All right, here's a good look at that touchdown again by Dylan Gabriel. Watch as he sees his receiver isn't open. He sees open grass, and he takes off. Christian Morgan just takes that absolute worst angle. Right now, he's perfect. Go to the outside shoulder, funnel him back in, but instead, watch, he goes to his left shoulder and misses the tackle completely as Dylan Gabriel is able to sneak inside that pylon for the opening touchdown on this opening drive.
So now Blake Shapin's first turn to work. Score Williams is in the game. The pass complete to Hal Presley. Really close to the marker, but just maybe a yard short. Blake Shapin talking to his offensive coordinator, Jeff Grimes. Look, they have full confidence in him. He did not turn the ball over last week, and that was probably maybe the biggest thing for him.
Yeah, and they made a decision in the offseason. They were going to go with the sophomore.
Turn around and hand it to Squirrel Williams. Got the first down, takes it past midfield. Good to see Squirrel back on the field. A fifth-year junior, has battled injuries throughout his career. First time that we've seen him since October 13th against West Virginia. They did tell us he was going to be limited today.
You see here, Blake Shapin, right, for the year, 5 interceptions. But the bigger thing, and it's not pictured here, is his fumbles. He just has not protected the football inside that pocket.
Turns around and hands it off to Williams. Gets a little bit of a push, falls forward over the 45-yard line into Sooner territory. They continue a 5-yard pickup. And talking to Jeff Grimes, he said, look, don't fumble and go be you. That was his message to Blake Shapin.
It's not an easy one when you have those issues, but if you understand ball security, and what to do with the football. Not removing the confidence of a young quarterback, the swagger of him, who really can throw the football, that's a huge part of it.
They fake the pitch out to Richard Reese. Over the top to Ben Sims. Bounces off one defender into another, and he's got the first down.
Well, when you got 6'5", 258 pounds out there on the perimeter, it's a pretty easy target for Blake Shaton. Good fake, moves around and immediately gets the ball out to his big tight end, who makes a guy miss and then picks up the first down to move the chains.
Ben Sims, they've used him a lot in his 5 years at Baylor. He is first in career touchdown receptions by tight ends at Baylor
time out
history.
For an injury.
And looking at this Baylor team, they want to run the football. I believe I've heard pound the rock so many times this week that it's pounded into my brain, but we've already seen them rotate. Richard Reese has been in for a snap. Quaylen Jones coming in. Squirrel Williams. Maybe they don't want 36 carries for Reese like last week. This is Jones.
You specified the 36 carries. I think it was out of necessity last week. They weren't planning to go out and do that. But this week, they hopefully can spread it around a little bit. Good job of meeting him in the hole. That's Danny Stutzman. Cut hair and all. Kind of lightened him up, I think. A little bit faster without all that hair.
Ted Roof told us Danny Stutzman did get a haircut, much to his parents' pleasure, after last week's game. Had an interception in that game. Oh, this one off the fingertips of Hal Presley. It was Jaden Davis right there in his pocket.
Really good job by Jaden Davis, right? He did not buy the play fake at all. He kept a good look and good discipline with his eyes and was right there. So when the ball was bobbled just a little bit, he was able to knock it away completely.
Jaden Davis coming off a game last week, 6 tackles for him, one short of a season high. And it is third down for Baylor in Oklahoma territory.
Not only third down, but third and long.
Pitch it to Squirrel. Looking for some room on the edge. Dropped at the 35, well short of the first down. Well, Robert Spears Jennings.
I think that really told you what they were going to do. They're going to go for it on fourth down simply because they ran this play. It puts defenses in a much different position. Watch as he gets to the outside. Almost finds a hole there, but a great tackle in pursuit.
David Agwebu in on that.
But defensive coordinators now, they have to think differently, knowing that they're going to get a fourth down play call.
Quaylen Jones, the bigger back, is in the backfield with Shapen. Looking to the air, over the top, pass caught. Josh Cameron gets the first down to the 20. Just his 8th catch on the season.
Yeah, that was it. 8th catch of the season. 4th down, they go to him. Not only do they go to him, they go to him on an in-breaking route where he's got to reach out and use his hands really well. He brings it in. Jaden Davis almost is able to rip it out. What a big conversion on 4th down to keep this drive alive.
And they've done it several times. 66% conversion rate on 4th down this season for Baylor. Ground game. Richard Reese to the 14. Tackle made by Key Lawrence.
Yeah, they are about as good as you could be on fourth down this year. And that's the one thing that we heard from Ted Roof around what he expects. He's got to have a plan in place for 4 downs most of the game because it's a different play call on third down when you know they're going to run the football. Usually you bring in a dime package or a nickel package and look for a pass, but as you can see there, they set up something a little bit shorter and converted on third down.
This will be the 10th play of the drive. They go pistol look with Squirrel Williams. Cuts back inside. Still needs 2 yards for the first down.
I'm just waiting for you to one time just play Squirrel.
I am going to. I'm waiting for the right moment, Ryan. Come on. Red zone offense this season, 83% for Baylor. Ball's at the 11. They need 2 yards here. They go I formation. They brought in Dylan Doyle as the fullback. They'll pitch it out to Squirrel Williams. He's got it. Inside, into the crimson. Baylor with a touchdown. Third rushing touchdown of the season for Squirrel.
Watch Connor Galvin here. Watch him just take his defender and say, nope. And he deposits him right into the cheerleader's lap as Squirrel gets into the end zone.
Look, this offensive line has been challenged. Last week, Jeff Grubb said they were physical. They imposed their will against Texas Tech. They've been waiting to see it. It was a highly touted group coming in. PAT is up and good from John Mayers.
Connor Galvin, the left tackle, says, hey, let's go for a ride and give some of the cheerleaders a pancake. Baylor marches down the field, seven rushes, four passes. They tie this game up, seven apiece early on in the first quarter. Now Noah Rauschenberg will kick this thing off for the Baylor Bears. Courtney Lyle, Ryan Leaf, and Tori Petrie with you. This is a big game for Baylor. Not totally out of the Big 12 race just yet. No, only two losses in conference. A little different because of Oklahoma and their three losses, but talking with Dave Aranda before the game on the field, he said he was really interested to see how his team would respond. You know, and this is exactly the example we needed for Oklahoma to go down and score and to watch the Baylor Bears respond in kind to tie this game up.
Well, all Baylor right. Put together a nice drive. Oklahoma did too. Dylan Gabriel 3-for-4, but also using his legs.
Yeah, I think that was the most impressive thing about that first drive. He was accurate as always with his arm, but once he saw that he had some green grass, he took off and was confident in running the football, steps out of bounds, picks up the first down, and then ultimately, at the very end, he finds himself as wide receiver on the outlet there, and then he takes off with his feet and just inexplicably makes a guy miss at the 5-yard line and steps inside before getting rocked out of bounds for the touchdown.
So now the defense aware that he's not afraid to use his legs?
Not afraid one bit.
Hand off to Eric Gray. Around the edge he goes, pushing forward to the 30, just over the 30 for a 5-yard pickup.
Real good patience, right? He This is, shows a real good patience on his part. Watch as he finds his path, and then he puts his foot in the ground and gets north and south to pick up positive yardage.
This time Gabriel will sling it out to the side. Braden Willis is his guy. A.J. McCarty in on the stop.
Really good job by A.J. McCarty, right? He squares his shoulders. It's always the biggest problem when you get in space with really athletic football players. And he's able to get him down to the ground and set up a third and short.
And Oklahoma 3-for-3 on third down early on in this game. Gabriel, a little pressure. Pass is tipped up in the air and taken away by Baylor into the hands of Dylan Doyle. T.J. Franklin tipped it up into the air.
The tipped pass, a quarterback's worst
result
enemy.
Result of the play is an interception by the defense.
And
first
a defender
down.
Sitting in zone's best friend. And there's Dylan Doyle right there. He looks back. Great job of just getting his hands up in the air. I believe that was T.J. Franklin gets his hand on it, and then Dylan Doyle right there stayed perfectly in place in that zone coverage to get a big turnover and set him up in really good field position.
Remember, this Baylor defense had 5 interceptions last week, their most since 1989. Blake Chapin, can he take advantage with this offense? Quaylen Jones, the big guy to the 9-yard line before Jaden Davis met him.
This is an incredible setup. I love the screen game when it's executed well and when you have a smart running back. Watch as he sits there. He's patient. He allows his offensive lineman to set up the blocks, and then he uses his athletic ability to pick up the first down.
So they're going to pause here. An injury. It is Jaden Davis. We've already said his name several times in this game, one of the key corners for Oklahoma. We'll step aside as Davis is able to get up. Baylor in the red zone. Jaden Davis was able to walk off the field. Torrey's working on an update for us on him. It is Baylor ball first down from the 9 in Oklahoma territory after a tipped pass. The interception by Dylan Gabriel set Baylor up in great field position. It's Jordan Nabors in motion. Richard Reese is the back, and he stopped at the 6-yard line. Let's check in with Torrey.
Courtney, no official word from Oklahoma on Davis, but they are wrapping his left ankle. Looks like they are trying to get him back in this game at some point, but we'll keep an eye on it.
Thanks for that update, Torrey.
Been really impressed, Courtney, with Jeff Grimes in the way he uses motion in his offense.
Nabors. Touchdown. This is Jordan Nabors. Wide open field in front of him. Marches in for the score.
We just talked about the motion and how much that affects the defense with your eyes. You have to be incredibly disciplined with your eyes there. Of course, they weren't. Great play call. They run the reverse and wide open. Take another look at it here. Watch the motion, man. He just kind of comes underneath, picks off the outside guy, and everybody was over pursuing so much. Nabors walks into the end zone. Baylor's got this crowd silenced.
Got really quiet inside the palace. John Mayer's on to attempt the PAT. It's up and it's good. Only 3 plays needed after Baylor's defense was able to force the turnover, an interception into the hands of Dylan Doyle. And then Jordan Nabors takes it in for the Bears.
Nabors just moves along underneath him. Watch as the tight end comes underneath, but no one is there. I mean, the over pursuit by Oklahoma, that shows the lack of eye discipline we talk about. And Nabors, the young freshman, and the speed on the perimeter, just walks and waltzes into the end zone.
Remember what Jeff Grimes told us? Look, he's explosive. They love to use him on the reverse, the jet sweep. Something exciting will happen when he gets the football. It could be good or bad.
Well, that's a lot of times when you have a freshman with that kind of athletic ability and kind of a cult mentality, you know, right out of the gate. And boy, they used it to their advantage there.
Farouk and Freeman back for Oklahoma as Rauschenberg set to kick this thing off. Into the front row. I know we talked about Baylor's defense. I mean, my goodness, 3 quarterbacks for Texas Tech last week, and they all threw interceptions. 5 interceptions by this Baylor defense.
Yeah, and they continue today with Dylan Doyle right off the bat getting another one. This is what changed that game late, because this game was a one-possession game late in that football game. And the defense stepped up and made some huge plays to get the ball turned over. You cannot overestimate what it means for a defense to make plays like this, especially when you can turn it in to 6 points, and that's exactly what Baylor did.
A.J. McCarty with the pick 6 there. They also had 6 sacks in that game, so Baylor's defense was rocking as Eric Gray is dropped. Pickup of 1 on the play. Al Walcott held on, grabbed him, and pulled him down.
That's going to be a necessity today. The way Jeff Lebby likes to space the football field out with his players to get guys in space and get them to the ground.
This is Farouk. Dancing up the sideline, and he does get enough for the first down to move the chains.
Well, that's incredibly impressive by Farouk. He just kept trudging along, right? He's about to get tackled for a loss, and he pushes himself down the sideline, stays in bounds, picks up the first down.
Off play action, Gabriel back to the air, got a wide open guy. Guess who it is? Marvin Mims! He caught that one, no doubt! Yards.
Play action fake. Good job by Dylan Gabriel. Uses his eyes, and then Marvin Mims just splits the corner and the safety and is all alone. Perfectly thrown ball outside shoulder, gently into the hands that you talked about. Had a few drops last week. Walks in for a touchdown.
Yeah, a couple of catches last week. Marvin Mims wanted to have back Jeff Lebby. The offensive coordinator told him, called him on Saturday after the game and said, we're coming right back to you. Zach Schmidt sends it up and good. Look at this ball game.
You're going to get a bit of a shootout. You know what's great about when you go back to a receiver like that? You know he's the star. You know he's going to make big plays for you. And it's just another thing, it's easy to get on a guy, coach him hard after you win the football game. There's a positive benefit there. Dylan Gabriel, play action fake, uses his eyes, and then absolutely throws a dime on the outside shoulder to a streaky Marvin Mims for touchdown.
Third straight season, Marvin Mims is leading this Oklahoma team in receiving yards. He can tack on 63 more to his total.
I mean, the speed, straight line speed, is NFL worthy. And that was an example right there. A.J. McCarty, he settled his feet for one split second and gone. I don't know if he was peeking inside, saw the play action fake a little bit, but Mims ran right by everybody in that defensive backfield.
Mims fourth in the Big 12 in receiving yards. He's ninth in receiving yards per game in the conference. Well, both teams have scored with just three plays on the last two drives.
Well, both coaches known for the defensive prowess.
So here we got a 14-14 game.
So right now we're talking 63-63 and maybe an overtime bit. We'll see.
It was so funny, too, because Brent Venables was asked, like, have you talked to Dave Aranda? He said, yeah, absolutely. We've talked before. I actually studied Baylor in the offseason about what they were doing, the improvements they made last year. So these guys know each other pretty well.
Well, yeah, I mean, you steal from the best, and you watch Dave Aranda take over this job, and they won two games. And then the next year they go out and win a Big 12 championship.
And they win 12 games, a school record last year. Flag is down as Chapin dumps it off, but the pass is going to be incomplete to Quaylen Jones. Looking like a hold?
Yeah, thrown in that vicinity.
Holding, number 65, offense. 10-yard penalty, replay first down.
That's the left guard, Micah Mazuka.
He catches the blitzer, and he kind of stumbles, and when he does, he has a hold of the outside shoulder of Luguebu, and he pulls him to the ground, and that's an easy call for the official right in front of him.
That's the first penalty on Baylor in this game. First and 20, Blake Chapin directing traffic, telling neighbors where to line up. He's got Squirrel Williams with him. Hal Presley. Looking for a gain, it's going to be a loss of two on the play. Jordan Kelly. He had a huge sack last week.
Now the decision by Presley here, he wants to go back outside, but he comes back underneath and just a wonderful job of keeping him contained and getting him to the ground. And now this is exactly what Oklahoma needed on the defensive side, to get a sort of penalty, a negative play, plus another negative one. And now Blake Chapin's not going to be in a good situation if he's got to be behind the sticks like this all game.
He pulls it from Reese. Chapin on the move to the 23. And this was moments ago, Jaden Davis walking back towards the locker room. Torrey told you they rewrapped one of his legs. It's one of the top corners for Oklahoma. Is it picked off?
They're saying no.
No. Wow, Justin Broyles was looking for interceptions in back-to-back games. But that hit the ground first.
Ah, it's just like post-traumatic stress for me. Watching over the middle throws for interception. It's just like,
are you okay?
The back and arrowhead, and all of a sudden everybody's coming at me. He just late over the middle, and Broyles is right in the spot, but he plays safety for a reason. You know, he's not on the wide receiver side. Ball goes through his arms, hits the ground.
The ruling in the field is an incomplete pass. The previous play is under further review.
They can review it all they want. That ball went right through the arms like it was covered in soap and absolutely bounced to the ground. But Blake Chapin right there sitting in the pocket waiting. As he was attempting to throw the ball, kind of felt somebody in his face. And then he overthrows somebody over the middle of the field. And you got a safety sitting back there and in zone coverage, and that ball goes right through his arms and bounces off the ground back into his chest.
You okay to see that again, buddy?
Well, I think I was just seeing the... Yeah, I'm okay. All right. I'll talk with my therapist this week, but we all right. We all right. You know, you learn quickly. Like, don't throw the ball over the middle late. Like, if you're going to throw it to the sidelines. You give your best shot. That's where guys get open. Let's take one more look at the Broyles attempt at the interception here. Just, you know, he goes down and tries to scoop it. Ball goes through his arms, and you see it bounce to the ground as it hits his thigh pad.
And that was the call on the field, too, that it was incomplete.
I don't know necessarily what's taking so long. But you can see it just fly right through him, bounces off that knee, almost rolls back in from his knee to his chest there.
Well, this should stand, though, and it should force Baylor to have to punt the football. And you're talking to Ted Roof, the defensive coordinator for Oklahoma. He said, we're playing with more confidence. We're more knowledgeable about what we're doing, about what each teammate is doing.
After further review, the ruling of an incomplete pass is confirmed. Fourth down.
You know, they had two bad games, and that kind of shook their confidence. So they went back to the basics some, and that's paying off. He sees a renewed confidence in this defensive group.
He does. I mean, when you're out there and you witness, right, 41 points by Kansas State, 55 by TCU, and then 49 in that drubbing in the Red River rivalry, yeah, you have a kind of come-to-Jesus moment, probably with your staff and your players, and you try to figure out what's best. And kind of a get-right game a week ago against Iowa State, getting all those turnovers and holding them to 13 points.
First punt of the ball game. Isaac Power for Baylor. Mims is back. He calls for the fair catch. And Oklahoma's offense will have a minute and 37 seconds left here in the first quarter. Already a 14-14 ball game. Dylan Gabriel, 6-for-8. 98 yards through the air, a touchdown and an interception today. He's also rushed for 35 yards and a score. Oklahoma with 161 total yards. Hand off to Tawi Walker. No, excuse me. Sent around the other way. Spinning just short of the 40-yard line for Oklahoma. Trevin West.
You have one play probably for Trevin West here, and it was reversed and allows the young player to use his legs, and he does a tremendous job.
This is Walker. Picks up one on the play, brings up third down before he was stopped by Matt Jones. Jackie Marshall also there. Gets another try.
Baylor had a good chance there of getting him down to the ground before he could pick up the first down, but he's able to keep those legs churning and inch forward and move the chains.
And now Oklahoma 4-for-5 on third down today.
Well, they've had all pretty manageable opportunities too, third and one, third and four, things like that.
Gabriel will keep it, looking for somebody to help him down the field, and sends it into the dirt. Had Marcus Major coming out of the backfield.
Pretty good coverage on the back end, though he had a chance with the coverage. This is going to be a good look at it. Good play action. He's got a guy over the middle if he wants to let it go, but he was kind of moving and never could get his eyes framed back right. He throws it in a place where no one else can catch it and moves on to fight another day.
Willis in motion. Major dances around, picks up one. Third down coming. Gabe Hall with the stop, and the clock runs down, most likely to the end of the first quarter. How about the ball game we got here, Ryan? 14-14 at the end of the first quarter. We've only seen one punt in the opening frame. Tie ball game in Norman.
Of our game's greatest legends. A unanimous first-team All-American in 2001, Roy became the first player in history to claim both the Bronco Nagurski Trophy and the Jim Thorpe Award in the same year, while leading OU to an 11-2 record and a win over Arkansas in the Cotton Bowl. The previous season, he led the undefeated Sooners to their first 13-win season in history and claimed the national title with an Orange Bowl victory. A two-time first-team All-Big 12 selection, he started 31 games, recorded 287 tackles, 34 tackles for loss, 9 interceptions, and 44 pass deflections during his OU career. Roy Williams now becomes the 23rd OU player to enter the College Football Hall of Fame, and he will officially be inducted December 6th in Las Vegas.
Steve Owens, Joe Washington, Billy Sims, and Brian Bosworth. OU Board of Regent Rick Nagel and Regent Chairman Frank Keating. OU President Joe Harris, along with Roy's family, Christy, Leia, Madison, and Roy Williams Jr. Now at this time, the National Football Foundation President and CEO Steve Hatchell, joined by NFF Vice Chairman Kathy Murphy, NFF Vice Chairman Clay Bennett, will present Roy Williams with an official Hall of Fame plaque. We'll then hand it to OU Athletics Director Joe Castiglione with permanent display here on campus.
Big round of applause as Roy Williams is honored. He will go into the College Football Hall of Fame on December 6th in Las Vegas, an All-American, the Big 12 Defensive Player of the Year. Got a natty to his name, the eighth overall pick for the Cowboys in 2002, a Pro Bowler, and really cool to see him honored on the field.
It is. It's so great to see these players honored for what they were able to accomplish. Of course, he went on to play and have a great career with the Dallas Cowboys.
And Torrey is going to chat with him later on here in the second quarter, but definitely a very exciting day to get to honor him inside a packed palace. Oklahoma on the move. Third down, Gabriel over the top, but it's picked off again. Baylor's defense, Devin Lemire. Make it two.
Absolutely great coverage here by Baylor. And then when you have good coverage like this, you don't just want to get one hand up, because when you do that, the ball gets tipped and you got that defensive player lurking back there in that zone coverage, and he's right where he needs to be to make that interception. And another turnover, and something Dylan Gabriel had only done one time up to this point this season. Now he's thrown two interceptions, both tipped balls, though. I will add, I don't know if there should be an asterisk for quarterbacks with those types of stats, but great coverage. Even better job on the defensive side.
And flags come out as there was movement early. Jaron Canick might have jumped a little early.
Yeah, the whole left side, really.
Number 70, defense, unabated to the quarterback. 5-yard penalty, first down.
See that again,
correction,
boys.
The foul is on number 7.
Yeah, that's Jaron Canick.
Let's take another look at that. 7 does a, you know, a good job of trying to anticipate the snap, but it almost felt like the left guard and left tackle were able to move.
So ball at the 29-yard line in Oklahoma territory as Baylor goes pistol look, and they pitch it out to Richard Reese, met by a host of Sooners. It'll be a loss on the play.
Justin Broyles just from the back end. I mean, he identifies this play immediately. Watch where he comes through. This was the play before, and it kind of looks like the left tackle and left guard move, but it looks like Seven may have stepped through there. Justin Broyles on the next play was just an absolute cannonball coming down to make that stop.
He's still fired up that he didn't get that pick early on the play. Early on.
Yeah.
Chapin with some time, airing it out. The deep ball to the corner of the end zone, looking for Monterey Baldwin, who makes his return. Pass incomplete. Now we'll send it down to Tori, who's standing by with Roy.
Thanks, Courtney. You know who just caught that last one? That was Roy down here.
I did.
Roy, how does today feel just being honored like this today?
It's surreal. I mean, I'm very fortunate and blessed to be able to play in Sooner Nation and to be a part of such an elite group. The 1,058 people that have made it out of the 5.6 players that played. So I'm fortunate. I love Sooner Nation, love my team. I'm tired of the picks that were thrown, but I mean, I'm back home, you know what I mean? This is home, I live here, but I'm so fortunate and blessed, man, to be a part of such an elite group, and I look forward to going to Vegas.
Thank you so much, Roy Courtney.
Thank you. In the zone at the snap.
So cool.
5-yard penalty, replay third down.
Pretty cool honor. I think anybody who plays college football and has any bit of success. There's only been just over 1,000 players, Courtney, ever inducted into the College Football Hall of Fame. Every year the ballot comes out in June, and then you find out in December who the next class will be. Roy Williams will be inducted in December in Las Vegas.
Yeah, December 6th. They give it up to Jordan Neighbors. Coming back the other way to Chapin.
I mean, good play call by Jeff Grimes there. He wasn't able to get enough on the football to get it back to the young quarterback. Instead, he catches it on the bounce, picks up what he can, and then puts them in a fourth and long situation.
So John Mayers comes out to attempt what would be a 49-yard field goal. His long of the season is 48, but his career high, 51. This will be 50. And it's good. A long boot from John Mayers. Tacks on some more points for Dave Aranda and the Baylor Bears.
Thank you.
Officially a 49-yard field goal for John Mayers and Dave Aranda's team up 17-14. A lot of that has to do with their defense. Two interceptions picking off Dylan Gabriel, who only had one coming into the game.
Yeah, they've been incredible, not only getting some pressure on the quarterback, but also in the back end, staying disciplined with their eyes, staying in coverage in that zone. So when the ball is tipped, there's somebody right there in that zone to intercept it. Transition turned into points on both sides, 7, and they're 3 for the field goal.
They had a whole conversation with this defense about effort a couple of weeks ago, and Baylor's defense showing a lot of effort here today. Look, Baylor is trying to beat Oklahoma in back-to-back years for only the second time ever. Last year, this game was wild. Baylor ended up scoring 24 unanswered points. It was the first loss for Oklahoma. They held Oklahoma to 250 yards, the fewest under Lincoln Riley.
There's a lot of things different about both these football teams, especially the quarterback position, as you see here in Baylor. But that was the first domino in Norman last year. The loss, the tumble, Spencer Rattler gone, Lincoln Riley gone, Caleb Williams all to the West Coast for some sunshine and surf.
Baylor went on to win 12 games, win the Big 12. Oklahoma takes it just short of the 30-yard line. Look, are you worried about Dylan Gabriel being able to flush that? He is an experienced guy, but two picks today.
Yeah, but as a quarterback.
Drake Stoops got the first down.
As a quarterback, you know what they were. They were both tip balls.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, if you were making a bad read, if you threw a bad ball, that's a different thing. He's a pro. He'll bounce back. I mean, once again, Drake Stoops he makes guys miss. He's been really impressive with the ball in his hand on the perimeter and makes a couple guys miss and then finds his way to pick up a first down. Speaking of Stoops, big game Bob just popped in here.
Just walked in, yeah. His dad, Bob Stoops, walked in, just came in the booth. Back to the air, no hesitation, but overthrows his intended target of Marvin Mims, who does have a pretty big touchdown catch today, 63 yards.
Yeah, there's an example from Dylan Gabriel where he's just got to put more air underneath the ball, right? Just let it go. Let his young receiver who has that breakaway speed run underneath it. Instead, he puts it a little bit too much up on a line, and you have to be just too accurate when you have that kind of arc.
So it'll be 2nd and 10 from their own 37. Ground game with Eric Gray. To the 41.
See that helmet come barreling out of there? I mean.
And there's a flag down, too.
Personal foul, hands to the face, number 2, defense. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down. Number 56 may stay in the game.
That's on Matt Jones.
Personal foul penalties will just absolutely kill you. Matt Jones just gets his hands into the face mask there, and off goes the helmet.
Play action for Gabriel. Incomplete, looking for Drake Stoops over the top.
All right, so back-to-back throws where the off-speed stuff, like the deep throw has to go more with arc here. He's got to take a little off it, have a little touch to this throw.
That was the previous play.
You got one-on-one down here at the bottom of the screen.
I'll go up to the top. I don't know if there was a miscommunication on the route, but that one sailed over Drake Stoops' head.
Okay, so the last three throws, I just was mentioning about the arc on the deep throw, the fastball where it should have been a bit of a changeup on the throw to Drake Stoops, and right there, I think it's just a bit of a miscommunication, maybe a bit of a misread in terms of where he had the most opening out on the football field.
Third down, Oklahoma is 4 for 6 on third down today. They'll shift it up, and Eric Gray will come in the backfield. Gabriel has to step up, now on the move, still gets the pass off to Eric Gray. Short of the first down, stopped by Al Walcott.
Watch this, Courtney. Watch as he maneuvers in the pocket here. He steps up, moves across. Watch the ball handling. He finds his guy when he knows he wasn't going to have enough to get the first down. He finds his open receiver in Eric Gray and almost picks up the first down and sets up a real chance for them to go here on fourth down, kind of in no man's land, right about the 35-yard line.
So Brooks Milner is the one that's helped off the field for Baylor. He was backing up that Will linebacker spot. They've had a couple of banged up players back there who are limited. Fourth and one.
It's always a question for me on whether or why you go shotgun.
Now they go wildcat. It's Marcus Major. Takes the direct snap.
Yeah, I don't think he got it.
No, I don't think so. Not from that spot.
Great job of penetration. He gets into the backfield. And just because of what I said, you're so far back there, you allow somebody to penetrate like that. He knocks him low to the knee. It gets short of that line to gain. And again, Baylor's defense steps up with a big play.
And Devin Neal. And then they do get the stop. Baylor's defense has been so tough. Two interceptions and then a big stop on fourth and one.
You know, as a quarterback, I hated being in the shotgun when you only need to gain 1 yard, especially when you're 6'5".
We'll step aside. Baylor's defense holding strong.
All right, here is the fourth down play. Marcus Majors is back there to get the football, and as he takes it, Conjol just isn't able to get to Devin Neal fast enough. And a great play by the defense to get a stop there. Conjol just can't quite get low enough, can't flex those knees low enough to get to Devin Neal to make that stop, and Neal sticks his nose in there, is able to trip up Major before the first down marker, and once again, we talked about the defense is just standing up to every challenge presented so far this football game.
Yeah, two picks and then a turnover on downs. Baylor's defense is feeling good. They'll hand it off to Squirrel Williams. He's had the most carries today. Wow, look at him go! Steps out at the 15.
If you remember what Jeff Grimes told us, he said, we've just lacked that explosive play. Explosive plays have not been there for this team today. And when you stack everybody kind of at the line of scrimmage, you make one guy miss in the hole like he does, and he's off. Makes that safety miss, and Washington does a good job of tracking him down, but that's a huge explosive play that Jeff Grimes, offensive coordinator for Baylor, was saying they were lacking this year. Huge response after getting a stop on the defensive side to get a big play on the offensive.
A 51-yard run, that's his longest of the season. It was interesting talking to Jeff Grimes, who said, look, we're balanced. We don't have that superstar, but we've been super efficient on offense. That's kind of been our calling card, just not the explosive plays, but they'll take that one.
Oh, gosh, yeah. They've been looking for that, right? They've been asking for players to make, you know, exceptional plays, and that's exactly what they got, setting up another opportunity to score for the Baylor Bears.
Yeah, Squirrel Williams with 7 carries, 79 yards. And a touchdown today in his return.
Rich.
Up the middle. Pushing forward. Short.
Pound that rock. That's what we heard all week, what we've heard every time we watched a broadcast with the Baylor Bears, and that's exactly what they do. And the offensive line just gets great push. I mean, the physical nature of them up front is making Oklahoma look like a JV squad up front. And that's where they've always been so good, right? Big, physical, Brent Venables staple, and they're just getting pushed off the ball so far.
Yeah, Jeff Grimes told us Squirrel Williams is going to be limited. I don't know about that. He's 8 carries now. Give him another one. Get him in the end zone. Squirrel Williams, touchdown, Baylor.
Maybe limited being touched by Oklahoma yeah. Sooners. But, I mean, they have looked explosive on offense, and that's what they were looking for. And Blake Shapen has to do much but manage the football game. Let the offensive line pound and pound, and Squirrel Williams just walks on into the end zone to put them up by 9 points.
Already 92 yards on the ground for Squirrel. Ground Squirrel.
I love it. I love it, Courtney.
His real name's Craig, if you just for the record.
It just doesn't have the same swagger.
It doesn't.
No. Especially when you're running all over the Oklahoma Sooners, you got to have a nickname. And Squirrel is very fitting for what he's doing on this grass field today.
Yeah, he has battled injury a lot of his career, but coming up big today. Remember, okay. They got the big stop on fourth down.
Yeah, huge play by Devin Neal to get into the backfield. Then they get the stop right before the first down marker. And immediately, the first play after, Squirrel Williams goes for a big explosive play and then caps it off with a touchdown. Watch the hole just open up. The offensive line has just overpowered this Oklahoma defensive line, and it's really making them, it's owning them, I think is the best way to put it. They're just owning them up front.
There was a lot of expectations on this offensive line coming into the season, and Dave Aranda and the team didn't feel like they lived up to those expectations. So they had a little conversation. There's been a lot of little conversations with both of these teams.
Yeah, when you have those type of expectations and you hear the applause and you go out and you lose 3 games before midway through the season where both these teams were expected to buy for a Big 12 championship, yeah, there's a come-to-Jesus conversation that has to happen. And you know, I think both squads have done that, don't get me wrong. Dylan Gabriel's the reason why this team has lost those games because he's been out, but today he's a big reason why Baylor's winning it. That along with the defensive line and how porous they've been so far.
Well, Dylan Gabriel was injured in the second quarter against TCU. He missed the Texas game. But a struggle today through the air. 2 interceptions. That pass is complete. It's a beauty to Marvin Mims.
If I get one-on-one matchups the rest of the way with Marvin Mims, I'm absolutely going to him every single time. Great job by Dylan Gabriel stepping up and hitting his big target on the outside.
That's a 33-yard gain. He's already had a 63-yard touchdown today, and Gabriel just has to get rid of it as a Baylor Bear right in his face. It's Gabe Hall.
Great job by Gabe Hall of not buying on the play fake, or on the pump fake. If you saw there, he pumps fakes, he stays on the ground. Great job stepping up in the pocket. He puts it perfectly on the outside shoulder, of course, of Marvin Mims. Picks up the first down on that big explosive play.
Two catches for 96 yards for Mims and a touchdown. Eric Gray shifting around, pushing forward. Still 2 yards short of the first down.
You know, during the Lincoln Riley era here, the defense was always very good at bending but not breaking. And Baylor kind of has that feel to it. They may be able to go back and forth, but they tend to stiffen up and bow their necks when they need to.
First down by Eric Gray. Moved the chains before Gabe Hall met him.
Good job using the motion, a little misdirection, and then Eric Gray just a good job of putting his head down and picking up that first down.
That's the 11th first down for Oklahoma. Puts him inside the Baylor 30. Gabriel with some time and lets it fly. Theo Weiss was the only receiver near.
There was a bit of miscommunication there. That play action fake was really to fool the linebackers and the safety, but Theo Weiss didn't do anything on the outside except kind of run a 2 yard turnaround, and Dylan Gabriel does the only thing there and just tosses it out of bounds.
Second and 10. They'll try it again. Back to Weiss. Caught it as he was dropping down. That's to the 26-yard line.
Yeah, the 6'3", 205-pound redshirt junior out of Allen, Texas there. Not able to keep his feet because he could have probably picked up the first down. Instead, now it sets up another third down opportunity to convert.
Gabriel up the middle. Faked it like he was going to throw it out to the flat and then said, nope, I'm taking it. Got the first down and takes it inside the 15.
Great inside by Jeff Lebby, knowing that the linebackers are going to move to that motion outside there on that fake pass. And he just plants his foot, goes forward, picks up the first down. Another good job by using his feet by Dylan Gabriel.
That's how Oklahoma got its first touchdown today, a run by Gabriel. He's got Eric Gray to the 5.
What makes Eric Gray so deadly is his ability to receive out of the backfield. He plants his foot again and finds his way over the football and almost scores.
He's going to score right there.
Great
flags
response.
Flags come out.
He was stood up kind of at the goal line there. I think some Baylor Bears took some pot shots at him, and offensive linemen, of course, aren't thrilled with that, protecting their brother.
But to your point, Ryan, those last two plays, Eric Gray, you see him with the catch, and then you just turn around and hand him the football. He takes it in.
All right, here's a look at that touchdown where they discuss the penalty. Good job of finding his way, weaving through, and then he just uses his physicality, reaches the ball over. Quite nowhere the things get started here, but
it was a late flag.
Yeah.
Well after the signal for the touchdown.
And it came from the cheap seats too, right? It was back corners where that flag came from, so clearly somebody from the back end there saw something.
It's still under discussion.
Inappropriate. Inappropriate, that's a good word for that.
Let's get some clarification here.
The ruling on the field is a touchdown. After the play was over, flagrant personal foul, number 54 on the defense. Unsportsmanlike conduct, number 64 on the offense. The fouls will offset. Number 54 for Baylor is ejected from the game. This is number 64's first foul for unsportsmanlike conduct on Oklahoma.
So that's Braden Utley, the defensive end who has been ejected for Baylor with the flagrant.
So you can't see really anything there. There's 54 on the top, and 64 comes down from the inside. It looks like he kind of throws a punch. So he must have seen something that happened down in the pile. There's some interesting things that happen in a pile, Courtney. I'm just telling you. They're not not made for national television.
Here. I'll take your word on it.
I think I used inappropriate a little earlier. I think that's a good vocabulary word for that.
Yeah. I think it was good.
Yeah.
I think you nailed it. That's a big loss for Baylor, though. They love the guys up front that they have, good rotation. Schmidt's PAT is up and good. The five-yard run by Eric Gray makes it a three-point game here in the second quarter. Baylor on top, 24-21. Braden Utley ejected from this game for a flagrant personal foul. We have the best look of it. They're about to kick off. We'll show you the look of what happened after that Eric Gray touchdown. But Baylor will be without him for the rest of this game. There was a personal foul assessed to Wanye Morris of Oklahoma. But he remains eligible. So here's what we were able to find on that last play after the Eric Gray touchdown.
Yeah, Utley. As the guy's going to the ground, Eric Gray, he reaches ahead with the football. And what I think Gutley's trying to do, and you can't do this because the guy's on the ground, he's punching at the football a couple times. But Wanye sees that from the other side, and he comes running in, and he punches Utley. And then it's a free-for-all. So the officials threw the flag when they saw the two punches thrown, and ultimately the retaliation by Wanye Morris. And there you have it.
Yeah, the flagrant personal foul is what it ejects Utley. Pass is complete over the top. A big pickup for Baylor. Josh Cameron with his second big catch today.
Wonderful job of using his body. When the ball was thrown behind him, Chapin hit just as he's letting it go. Look at him turn and use those hands to grasp the football and breach it into his body right in the middle of that zone. To pick up another first down.
This is just his second multi-catch game of the season. The first was against Kansas when he had two catches for 10 yards. That's a 20-yard pickup right there for the Bears. Squirrel's turn. He's been the featured back today for Baylor, coming back from injury. And he's got the first down.
Yeah, Courtney, from up here, you could really see the leverage and numbers that they had on the outside. And that was probably a read option for Chapin, but he had no choice but to give this football, as there was no one out there to set that edge. And Squirrel gets out to the outside, picks up a first down.
Over 100 yards on the day for Squirrel Williams. They fake the pitch out. Roll out and throw it to Kelsey Johnson, who is stepping in for the injured Drake Dabney. And he's pushed out by Key Lawrence.
You know, we talked about that eye discipline early on, how it cost Oklahoma there. Key Lawrence does a tremendous job of staying disciplined, staying in the spot he needs to be on that bootleg. And when 87 Kelsey Johnson's outside there, Key Lawrence is right there to make the tackle and put him back almost behind the sticks.
Second and 10 coming up from the 45 in Oklahoma territory. Squirrel cut back to the inside, leaping forward, but will be marked short of the first down by a yard. To the 35 he goes. It's a pickup of 9.
Jeff Grimes was brought in here a couple years ago to institute this type of running attack where they have large splits on the offensive line, and it allows for that kind of spacing where the defensive end has no choice but to commit to the quarterback in a run option look, and just a big hole for Squirrel to bounce through and almost pick up the first down, sets up a third and short.
He's already got a season high in this game with 112 yards. Just short off of the fingertips of Josh Cameron.
Courtney, what a great play call. And this is kind of the thing Jeff Grimes talked about, Blake Chapin and his inability to execute. He's not able to set his feet and get the ball out to the wide open Cameron, who may have scored. He had a blocker down the football field, but he has to try to stop, and his momentum just carried him away from the football.
They go I formation, Dylan Doyle in at the fullback position. Cameron in motion, they hand it off to Doyle. Should be good to move him.
Yeah, just enough. Another fourth down executed play. They're going to be the number one team in the country before we know it. Started this week at 18th in the nation at 67%, and now 2 for 2 so far today.
And Jeff Grimes loves being able to use Dylan Doyle, who's their middle linebacker as well, but a great fullback.
They got lucky. He runs right into the back of Connor Galvin, that big left tackle. And well, luckily enough, he's able to force his way through and pick up just enough for the first down.
He said he's really physical, and we saw it there. Squirrel, not a ton of room, will pick up a yard. Stopped by Jordan Kelly.
That's the kind of discipline you need from that defensive line there. They need to stay in their gap and be responsible for said gap. And sure enough, they were able to make the tackle. And we just need more of that. They just have not been disciplined so far in this first half. And I know it's difficult. This offensive line will push you around. They're big and physical, and they make things difficult for the guys up front.
Chapin. Picked off. Oklahoma has it. Sooners return the favor. A pick by Billy Bowman. They are so glad he's back for the second straight game.
First down, Oklahoma.
Wonderful job of staying disciplined back there. Billy Bowman sitting.
Give me a timeout.
First turnover by Baylor, and it comes from Billy Bowman. Glad number 5 in crimson is back if you're a Sooner. Blake Chapin with the interception, his sixth of the season. Picked off by Billy Bowman. And now Dylan Gabriel is going to roll out and complete the pass. The first down is there, and Oklahoma will move the chains with Farouk.
All right, let's go back to that interception. He steps up in the pocket, but anytime you're throwing over the middle there, you got to be accurate with the football because you have that safety sitting right in the backfield, defensive backfield, and he's right there on the spot to get it. If you're not accurate with that throw over the middle, and it cost him.
Eric Gray on the handoff. Back inside, gets a couple more because of it, and takes it to the 36-yard line. Stopped by Garmin Randolph.
This game's kind of been like both this team's season, right? It's just been up and down, and there's been ebb and flow and adversity to overcome, and I love how Oklahoma's responded after getting down by 10 points.
They fake the handoff to Willis. Gabriel calls his own number, tripped up around the 40-yard line, short of the first down. 5-yard pickup. Oklahoma 6-for-9 on third down. Gabriel stops, plants, completes the pass. Jahlil Farouk.
Farouk does a wonderful job of just posting up, giving his quarterback a target where he can put it right to him and move the chains.
Oklahoma will try to move a quick bit faster here. Was that picked off too?
Yep.
Christian Morgan.
Another tip ball.
Three times now, Dylan Gabriel has been picked off.
Defender's best friend is that tip ball.
The ruling on the field is an interception by the defense. First down, Baylor.
And Marvin Mims was open down the field. Dylan Gabriel get kind of a earful there on the sideline. He's able to set his feet and let it go right there. Mims has him beat. Instead, he throws kind of off kilter, off balance. Wonderful job by the defender to go make another tip. Lorando Johnson, he makes the play, and another interception and another turnover for Dylan Gabriel, right? One on the year coming into this game, and now he adds three to the mix, all on tip balls from this defense.
Third interception of the season for Christian Morgan to lead Baylor. Their third of the game. That's really allowed them to hold on to this lead. Ben Sims was thrown down, did not catch the football. Not sure if the defender could see that he didn't catch it.
Yeah, I think that what the official saw there, he couldn't tell whether or not Ben Sims held on to that football as he tossed him to the ground.
You know, talking about Blake Chapin, the coaches have told us he's internalized some mistakes and some losses. We saw him throw that interception. How do you shake it off?
Well, I mean, you just do as a quarterback. You know, you Ted Lasso it. You goldfish it.
Dropped for a loss of 6.
Good job of staying in the effort to get to the quarterback. Chapin's got to eye that a little bit better. Maybe to your point, maybe there's a little hesitation on whether he could pull the trigger right there because of the interception on the previous series. Instead, he holds on to it a little long. Jalen Redmond gets him to the ground.
Baylor 1-for-5 on third down, and this is a third and long. Quaylen Jones dropped for an even bigger loss. Jaron Kanick.
Yeah, the freshman out of Hayes, Kansas, just.
Timeout. Oklahoma, their first of the half. It will be 30 seconds.
That's exactly the response you needed, the help you needed from the defense after throwing a third interception.
It's huge for this Oklahoma team because the offense keeps giving it back to the Baylor offense, and sure enough, the defense makes a big stab. Jaron Kanick, and they get the timeout, hopefully to give Dylan Gabriel in this offense an opportunity to get some points before half.
Isaac Power on to punt. His first punt was 46 yards. It'll be Mims back at the 40. Bounces into Mims' hands. Dragged down short of the 45. That so not Courtney, bad field position if you're Oklahoma.
That, Courtney, is exactly the truth there. That's what makes a great punt returner. Not necessarily always catching the ball in the air, but when the ball is hit poorly, you just don't let it roll out. That ball could have continued to roll, taken up much more yards. Instead, he gets the ball and gets them in very good field position to end this half.
Marvin Mims has been great today.
Watch Mims here. He lets that ball roll. It goes back maybe 10, 15 more yards. Instead, he picks it up and picks up a few more yards to put them in a much more manageable position here before the half with two timeouts left.
54 seconds. They'll go empty here. Gabriel with time, but now running out of time and dropped at the line of scrimmage. Bryson Jackson.
I know you have the two timeouts, but the only thing you can't do there.
Second charge timeout, Oklahoma. It'll be 30 seconds.
Is take a sack. You know, it defeats you in terms of what you want to do play calling wise. It defeats you in the momentum aspect of things, and you have to use one of the timeouts that you wanted to use later down the field. You know, let the ball go, let it fly, throw it over somebody's head out of bounds. You know, you're going to have to play the next play anyway, but you don't cost yourself a timeout, and you don't have that negative feeling. And there's just a momentum feel about getting sacked and brought to the ground for your O-line and for the team and everybody on the sideline when that happens.
How has Dylan Gabriel look compared to maybe what we saw last week?
Well, he's been shaky. I mean, that's the best way to put it.
Correction, Oklahoma is elected to take a full timeout. Oklahoma is elected to take a full timeout.
These officials like to tell us things. And very accurate.
Well, now we know.
Now we know. So now we can explain it a little bit better. To your question, he's looked shaken today. And that can happen when the ball starts kind of coming out of your hand differently, gets tipped around, defense is making plays. Baylor now has 8 interceptions in the last 6 quarters of football. I mean, that can make you see ghosts out there as a quarterback, right? I don't know if I ever threw 3.5, but I know what it feels like to throw a bunch of interceptions and feel like you're really contributing to what the team's downfall is.
Now, Baylor with 3 picks today. They had 5 interceptions last week. Gabriel stepping up, looking for help. Mims has been his big-time helper today. That'll move the chains.
I thought Dylan may take off there, but he finds his target over the middle field, gets the clock to stop with the first down and the moving of the chains.
It's a 16-yard pickup to the 40. And it was almost another interception off of the arms of Christian Morgan, who just picked off Gabriel.
So wide receiver stumbles and falls coming out of his break. It was a good concept, but then Morgan's got to catch that football. See if Oklahoma takes advantage of that mistake by Morgan and the Baylor defense.
Second and 10 from the 40. That will move the chains. It's complete to Farouk.
Both him and Stoops were in the same area. I don't believe that was meant to be, but they get a completion, get a first down, and keep moving.
They can hustle. Gabriel moving flags everywhere. He steps out inside the 10, but this one may be coming back on a hold.
Oh, yeah. A lot of time off the clock. That puts him now in a much more difficult field goal attempt situation.
There are 2 fouls in the play. Holding, number 73, offense. That penalty is declined. Personal foul, hands to the face, number 73, offense. 15-yard penalty, replay second down.
Both on Andrew Rehm, the center.
Rehm said, I'm just going to get it all. He gets his hand to Dylan's face and then just...
Correction, it's first down.
Keeps on pushing. Now moves him back and sets up a 55-yard attempt with 5 seconds left in this half to tie it up.
And this would be a career long for Zach Schmidt. His career high is 46 yards. His season long is 44. And Baylor's going to call a timeout.
Second charge timeout of the half. Baylor, it will be 30 seconds.
I always found this interesting, the chess match, the mind games around calling timeouts to try to maybe ice a kicker.
Hey, remember Zach Schmidt, though, last week? He had all 13 of their first half points. Two field goals, had the touchdown reception from Michael Turk, the punter, who's the specialist of the week in the Big 12.
So he's clearly the guy that you want to try to score this week.
Like, just giving a little love to the kicker, okay? I know how you feel.
I love kickers. Come on, man. I don't really love kickers. If he makes it, I like him a little bit more. And if I'm a Sooners fan, I'm loving him.
This will be a 55-yard attempt. It would be a career long for Zach Schmidt. No good.
Boy, he had the leg for it,
yes,
though. And that would have gone from 60. Just tugs it a little left. Good contact. He just has a little more rotation. It looks good halfway there and just keeps drawing just a little bit. Outside the left, upright. And they head into the half, down three.
Baylor taking advantage. Their defense able to come up with three interceptions of Dylan Gabriel, who had only thrown one pick this season coming into the game. Baylor leading 24-21 at the half. What a first half we've already had.
Oh, it was incredible. An incredible first half.
Dave Aranda standing by with Tori.
Coach, a little bit of a shootout in this one, but if there's one thing your defense has been able to do, it's interceptions. What do you need to see from them in the second half?
More discipline, I think, whether it's gap assignments or it's eyes in the back end. It's communication during the no huddle. There's a fair amount that's going wrong that we got to get fixed.
We weren't sure whether Squirrel would be able to do too much in this game. Looks like he's doing fine out there. What has he been able to add to your game plan?
Energy. I think when everyone knows Squirrel's story and what he's been through, and for him to continue to come back from whatever obstacle that meets him is inspiring, and I'm glad he's with us.
Thanks so much, Coach Courtney.
Yeah, Squirrel Williams injured time and time again, but he's back with 12 carries, 113 yards, and two touchdowns in the first half to help Baylor take a lead into the locker room. 24-21 Bears is your score at the half.
Come see the best two teams from the Big 12 Conference go head-to-head to crown a champion. In the Dr. Pepper Big 12 Championship Game, Saturday, December 3rd at AT&T Stadium in Arlington, Texas. Experience the energy, excitement, and passion of Big 12 football's biggest stage. Get your tickets now at SeatGeek.com.
For over 131 years, the University of Oklahoma has been making an impact. It is a legacy of excellence, a legacy defined by courage and determination, a legacy of champions, both on and off the field. And we're not done yet. From big wins to bigger discoveries, we're advancing Oklahoma, the nation, and the world. Because at the University of Oklahoma, we change lives.
It has been a beautiful day here in Norman, Oklahoma. Halftime between Oklahoma and... It has been a beautiful day here in Norman, Oklahoma. Halftime between Oklahoma and Baylor. We're certainly glad you've joined us on Big 12 Now. And as you know, Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus, it is a must-have for Big 12 fans. Each Wednesday, 8 p.m. Eastern, Chunky Kemp and Harold Kuntz break down Saturday's games, and they're going to preview upcoming week on the Big 12 Football Weekly Show. Also, tomorrow at 1 p.m. on ESPNU, it is the 2022 Sprouts Farmers Market Big 12 Soccer Championship. That is West Virginia and TCU. So make sure you tune back here to Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus for both of those things. Halftime in Norman continues when we come back. How the Sooners are getting out in the community and making a difference off the football field here at Norman. Between Oklahoma and Baylor. Well, Brent Venables, Oklahoma's head coach, really concerned, obviously, with what his guys do on the field, but also who they are and what they do off the field. So much so, he made sure they got out into the community during the bye week and gave back to Norman. Great day to be at the great day to be at the Palace. Halftime between Oklahoma and Baylor. Well, Brent Venables, Oklahoma's head coach, really concerned, obviously, with what his guys do on the field, but also who they are and what they do off the field. So much so, he made sure they got out into the community during the bye week and gave back to Norman.
Well, today we're painting the fence of a single mother and put together a play set for her and her children in the backyard. We're spread out through the community, competing with one another. We got eight different teams that are doing a variety of different projects for a bunch of different groups that need some help, need some volunteer work. So, as we say all the time, everybody can be great because everybody can serve. And so there's an opportunity for us to give back and serve others, help where it's needed. You know, for us, we call that keeping the main thing the main thing.
I'm building a playground.
Like, what's his name?
Hey, where's my waiver?
Bobby Builder. We got green beans, we got peas, we got corn. Just one, though.
There's somebody take this to the track. Oklahoma football, Bills on wheels.
Curtis Lofton, man, how are you?
Nice to meet you,
sir. How you doing, General?
General, you're the one, man.
Yes, sir.
How you doing?
Good. Mr. Charles, did you serve in the military?
Yeah, I was
in
the Marines.
Thank you for your service.
Thank you so much.
I still got the camera.
Nice door right there.
And you know, man, we up here at the Buddy Bench Building Program. You know, we building benches, you know, for Norman, Oklahoma.
Come on, buddy, come on.
You know, it means a lot. You know, we don't realize how blessed we are. And we don't realize, you know, how many other people are going through unfortunate times. So to be able to, you know, put some of our, you know, able bodies to work, it just means a lot to be able to give back to the community, man.
Hey, I'm Brent.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah, nice to meet you. All right, we're not finished. Okay, we're not finished, y'all.
How are you?
Good.
Thank you very much.
Nice seeing you.
Nice seeing you.
A salad today, you feel me? Tomatoes with the salad, you feel me?
Can't be ball 24/7, and these young guys are going to be finished playing very soon, and so important that they again learn the value of what it's like to help people in need and take time to, you know, have the proper balance and vision for, you know, what living a fulfilling, you know, significant life looks like.
We learn it as we go, but all I'm thinking right now is feeling everything.
Sooner service, what a great way to spend the bye week. We are going back to football in just a moment. When we come back, Matt Berry's got you set in the studio with a preview of what's to come later tonight.
where the story followed. So against the Giants.
Big time Big 12 matchup, Oklahoma and Baylor at the half. There's another big SEC West matchup coming up. Matt Barry and the team got you covered with a preview.
On any other weekend, Alabama-LSU would be the show pony matchup. So many SEC West implications in this one. But look, LSU has found their groove, but they got to get past a tough Alabama defense.
They got to get past a defense that finally has found its groove as well. Ever since giving up all those touchdowns to Jalen Hyde against Tennessee, the Alabama defense has found their groove. But they're going to have to really be challenged this week. Jaden Daniels is playing his best football to date.
Break it down, Coach.
Yeah, Jaden Daniels is a guy that's dangerous. He's getting much more comfortable within their offense, but he's dangerous with his legs. Extending plays, being able to look downfield, making it hard for you to cover the receivers as he scrambles around to make plays. Now, where he's unbelievable right here, he has 646 yards rushing on the year, and a lot of it comes in these situations where he drops back, you pressure him, you rush him, he scrambles, gets a first down with his legs. Some of it also comes with design quarterback runs right here, his athleticism to go make plays in the run game in a design quarterback run. He has 11 total touchdowns in the last two games. He has become a game changer in this offense. First-year head coach,
yep.
First-year quarterback that transferred in, and all of a sudden, there's comfort.
That marriage is there, especially starting that Florida game 3 weeks ago, did it against Ole Miss. But here's what surprised me. Look at those Alabama defensive numbers. I'm surprised they're so highly ranked in the SEC defensively, because the Tennessee game was an absolute torch in terms of numbers and statistics.
Well, Tennessee does that to everyone. That's who Tennessee is. But outside of that game, and obviously they struggled against, like, think about Texas. They struggled. That was like a 20-19 kind of game,
yeah.
Even though they gave up bigger plays and had a lot of penalties. So it's not necessarily the points they're giving up outside of Tennessee. It's just sloppy play that we're not used to seeing.
Yeah, and that's been getting fixed in this deal. I love the Alabama defensive line, and you look at Will Anderson. Might not have put up the huge numbers, but he gets pressure. And they are going to try to make Jaden Daniels stand in the pocket and see if he can beat them from the pocket.
If he stands, he's not a pocket guy. He's a get out and move around. And those kind of quarterbacks have historically given Nick Saban defenses problems.
All right, guys, we still have one half to play here in Norman. First half stats and highlights coming up when you come back. Ready for the third quarter here in Norman. Courtney Lyle, Ryan Leaf, and Torrey Petrie with you. Three picks by this Baylor defense helped them take this lead into the locker room, and Baylor will get the ball first. Take a look at the first half stats. Oklahoma dominated total yards, but the three turnovers crushed them.
Yeah, the three turnovers resulted in 10 points on that side of things. And, you know, Dylan Gabriel's just got to get with Jeff Levy at halftime and figure it out in the second half. They cannot afford to keep turning the football over because they're in this game. I mean, it's not like Baylor's run away with it. They have every opportunity to win this football game in the second half.
So Blake Shapen and company set up shop first. It's Jordan Neighbors down the sideline past the 50. Tripped up at the 45 in Oklahoma territory.
You really can tell what the coaching staff thinks when they come out with their script for the first to the second half, and they just felt that they could get some of those over-pursued plays like they did on the touchdown by Neighbors. This time they do it in the open field, and he just breaks for a big explosive play.
And Oklahoma's taking a look at Key Lawrence. Torrey, what did Brent Venables have to say coming out of the locker room?
Courtney, coach told me that he told his quarterback, hey, man, you just got to settle down. He's trying to play to the wind too much. They don't want him to worry about that. They just want him to be himself. They feel like he can throw BBs all day, so they just want him to be able to do that. They also talked about their defense and what they need their defense to do in the second half. They just said they want more discipline. He feels like that they have been giving up those interceptions. He said, all due respect, but we feel like those were mistakes on our part, and we can fix that in the second half. Courtney?
We talked about the discipline pretty much all half. I think I mentioned that word a bunch on the defensive side of the football for Oklahoma. And right off the bat, first play, discipline, right? Not looking with your eyes, but being fooled with the misdirection. And that's why Neighbors gets away for a big play. And so what's bothered them throughout the first half, you know, rears its ugly head immediately to start the second on defense.
It was a 32-yard pickup for Neighbors. Key Lawrence is able to walk off the field on his own. Torrey will try to get us an update on Key. Over the top, Josh Cameron, first down. Two big plays for Baylor.
And Cameron's been really special already today. Three catches. They find him over the football. There must have been something in film that they saw that they could take advantage of. A little delay by Cameron there. Stutter steps his way to the middle of the field, and Shapen puts it on him for another first down.
Remember, Josh Cameron had seven receptions coming into this game. They pull it, and then they'll go ahead and turn it and throw it to Richard Reese. Are you surprised we haven't seen Reese with as many carries or just as many touches? It's been Squirrel Williams with 12 carries today, Richard Reese with just three.
Well, when you got capable guys in the backfield like that, you kind of roll with the hot hand, and Squirrel Williams has been that hot hand so far in this football game. That was a unique play action fake to him as they run a run-pass option look and then toss him the football to pick up a few yards.
Now they'll bring in Quaylen Jones as the back for Blake Shapen. Handoff goes to him, cuts back inside over the 20. Still short of the first down by about 3 yards.
I mean, this is the staple of Jeff Grimes' offense and how they run the football. Watch as Shapen just rides him with the mesh a little and then allows the running back to find those big holes that the offensive line are able to create and put him in a very manageable opportunity to convert here on third down. I would suspect they're in a situation right now where they would go for it on fourth down if they don't get it.
This is Quaylen Jones. They don't have to worry because they got it, and he's still going. He is their bigger back, and he's finishing forward better.
Well, I bet during halftime when coaches are making their halftime adjustments that Jeff Grimes talking with all his staff, they said, we're just owning the line of scrimmage. Let's continue with that here on the first drive, and that's what they've done. Offensive line has a good get-off, pushes the defensive line back 4 or 5 yards, and they're able to get another first down.
Brent Venables told Torrey at the start of the game the lines of scrimmage would be the deciding factor in this game.
Well, it definitely has been the deciding factor so far, right? It's only 24-21. It's not like it's a blowout here, but the explosive nature of what Oklahoma has done on offense has allowed for Baylor to kind of control more on the on the more physical side of things up front. And it's just, you know, if you're a Sooners fan out there, it's got to be incredibly frustrating hearing me talk about it over and over again.
They go under center and they toss it over to Squirrel. Looking for room on the edge. He is dragged down, David Ogwebu. And a flag comes out.
Great job by Ogwebu as he chases him down. Wonderful tackle in the backfield. There's a little extracurricular there.
After the play was over, personal foul, unnecessary roughness, defense number 94. At the distance to the goal line, automatic first down, number 55 may stay in the game.
That's Isaiah Coe for Oklahoma.
Watch here as Isaiah Coe, after the tackle, is engaged with an offensive lineman, and there's a little extra push on the offensive lineman side. Responded by Coe by grabbing his face mask and just ripping the helmet off his head. Can't have that happen.
Swirl Williams. Oklahoma's defense ready for him. Jalen Redmond in there.
Brent Venables told Torrey that this half was going to be about discipline, and right there's an example of being very undisciplined, getting moved around a little bit, and then retaliating by grabbing the face mask and ripping somebody's helmet off.
The ball is at the 8-yard line. Quaylen Jones has come back in. Two wide receivers to the near side for Blake Shapen. He's looking towards the top. And flag comes out. The pass was intended for Hal Presley. CJ Colden in coverage.
Little delayed throw by Shapen there. But he threw it in a way where...
Pass interference, number 22, defense. The penalty, the foul occurred in the end zone. The ball will be placed at the 2-yard line. First down.
Threw it in a way where CJ Colden, all he can do, and instead of turning his head around, he just pushes through, and the receiver does a good job of kind of coming back to the football. When you have an underthrown pass like that, that's what the receiver does so well to get the call. Made it pretty easy for the official that was standing right there.
Baylor's brought in some beefed up personnel. Tate Williams comes in wearing number 92 on this play. Dylan Doyle is the fullback. They'll hand it off to Reese, leaning forward, and it's a Baylor touchdown.
Absolutely dominating drive coming out at halftime. Great halftime adjustments on the offensive side of the ball for Baylor. They just imposed their will all the way down the field. Dylan Doyle leads the way, and then Richard Reese, who we haven't seen too much of today, uses his ability to get low and get into the end zone.
Pounding the rock all the way down the field for Baylor.
Pound the rock is a good phrase right there. This team has been really good all day running the football. Richard Reese with a touchdown to open the second half. They take a 10-point lead as the Baylor Bears roll on the offensive side of the football.
A 9-play, 75-yard drive down the field gives Baylor a touchdown to start the third quarter. They now have a 10-point lead. Oklahoma will send Farouk along with Freeman back as Noah Rauschenberg gets set to kick this off.
Last time they were down 10, Oklahoma responded with a big drive. Let's see how they respond here.
Farouk wanted to take it out, but he's going to take a knee. Dylan Gabriel, 3 interceptions, came into this game with 1. What stood out to you about his first half?
Well, I feel like he was just a little hesitant in some of his throws, and he felt the pressure and made some decisions there. All 3 of the interceptions, you got to understand, were all tipped too, right? Good defense there, able to get the ball tipped into the air and right on the spot to make the interception. This one was an ill-advised throw. He should not have let it go that way. The wind dictated a little bit, and sure enough, Morgan gets the interception. 3 of them in the first half. I question whether I had 3. I was told by my mother. My mother texted me and said, hey, you threw 3 against the Giants.
Oh, really? So, it was her.
Very good, Mom. I appreciate you knowing that stat.
That pass batted down, incomplete by Al Walcott.
The play action, but Al Walcott's not fooled at all, and he just uses his big mitt on the right hand there to knock the pass down. Just sluggish feel to Oklahoma to start the second half offensively and defensively.
They call on Eric Gray. Falls forward to pick up with 2. Gray's 10th carry of the game.
This is a huge play right here. Like, if they don't get off the, you know, if they don't keep this drive going and Baylor's able to get off the field, that's like that brings some pressure here, man coverage.
They go empty, and when they needed a big play, they've gone to Mims today. He is at the top of your screen, number 17 in crimson.
Look at the middle of the field there, Courtney. Remember that quarterback draw a little bit earlier for Dylan Gabriel?
He's going to have to move. Can't get rid of it. Baylor swarming him. Garmin Randolph takes him down. Back in the 23-yard line. Baylor worst, defense again.
Worst possible start to the second half. Giving up a huge, physically draining, you know, drive by the Baylor offense. And they're going 3 and out with 3 little suspect plays on the quarterback. Randolph gets him to the ground, and now they have to punt the ball away.
This is Oklahoma's first punt today. Michael Turk, who is a huge weapon for them, he had a 61-yard punt last week, the specialist of the week. And they run right into the return man. A flag is out. Gavin Holmes was back there. I believe he called for the fair catch.
Catching interference, number 24 on the kicking team. 15-yard penalty, first down.
Crowd here in Norman not happy with that. It looks like he gets blocked into him a little bit, and that's what I think the Norman crowd here is so upset about. 27 just gets a hand in his back a little bit, but you got to be more aware of where you are on the football field. That's a big part of what Brent Venables was talking about and the disciplined aspect of things. You have to be more disciplined in that position to not be around that player.
And now goes to Craig
Here at Baylor, the ground attack has worked very well today. 162 rushing yards.
Yeah, they haven't asked much from Blake Shapen, and when they have, he's made a mistake, but for the most part, kind of kept the drive going when they needed it.
Second and 11. Back to running the football once again. This one just shy of midfield. Well, at halftime, Oklahoma honored the national champion softball team. They are led by head coach Patty Gasso, who has built an absolute dynasty here in Oklahoma, and she's standing by with Tori.
all about Coach Gasso. Coach, your team was honored at halftime here today. I know a big summer for you guys. What did it mean to be honored in front of this big crowd?
The crowd and the fans have been wonderful to help us get where we need to go. It's them honoring us. It's us honoring them. So it was great. Fantastic.
I know you're excited. You just broke ground on your new facility. What are you looking forward to about that?
Bringing all the fans in. Now we have enough room for them. It's going to be first class for not just our team, but our opponent, and the athletes will have first class amenities as well. So we're really excited. It's long overdue.
Number 16,
thank you so much, Coach Gasso. We appreciate it. Courtney?
15-yard penalty. Replay third down.
So they'll replay that big third down. Yeah, Patty Gasso, it's incredible the players that she has brought in. Jocelyn Allo, the home run queen, all-time home run leader. But I'm excited to see T.R.A. Jennings returning for this Oklahoma softball program, too.
Big 12 softball is an absolute monster all over the country. No matter where you're living, you always see that showcased every spring. And they've dominated in this conference for some time now.
That was a big penalty because that was going to be a nice pickup for Baylor. Oklahoma's got to get a stop here. Third and 20. Empty look for Blake Shapen and the Bears. He'll dump it off fast to Josh Cameron to the 40. Nowhere close. Oklahoma needed that desperately.
Well, they needed it desperately. They went to their best player on defense, David Agwebu. He's right there on the spot to pick up a big tackle to get them off the field and now give the offense an opportunity to respond and get back in this game.
Isaac Power on to punt. Mims is back for Oklahoma. Hard hit taken by Mims, and they'll stop him about the 22-yard line.
Media timeout.
So Oklahoma offense, can they turn that stop into some points? Dylan Gabriel back to work on the other side.
Helping those that help others. That's the mission of Charity Champions, a program designed to support nonprofits in Central Texas. Charity Champions started in 2014 to celebrate TFNB, Your Bank for Life's 125th anniversary. Champions get a marketing awareness campaign and world-class leadership development training from local consulting firm 360 Solutions. 8 years, 49 champions, and we're just getting started. Learn more at charitychampions.org.
Tundra. Toyota. Let's go places.
Well, folks, it's only 8 a.m. and it's going to be another hot one. Today's high is 85 degrees with lows ranging in the upper 50s. Tomorrow's more of the same, plus some light wind coming in from the northeast. Coming up at 8:30, Paul's got an exclusive.
Babe, it's 8 a.m.
Fried chicken, better with Pepsi.
Howdy, Chet Garner here, professional guide, searching for bears in the wild. But not just any bears, oh no, a particular kind. With hundreds of thousands roaming freely in the wild, yet still hard to spot unless you know the signs. There they are, Baylor bears. If you're a bear enthusiast or even a bear yourself, join me and let's find some bears in the wild.
Helping those that help others. That's the mission of Charity Champions, a program designed to support nonprofits in Central Texas. Charity Champions started in 2014 to celebrate TFNB, Your Bank for Life's 125th anniversary. Champions get a marketing awareness campaign and world-class leadership development training from local consulting firm 360 Solutions. 8 years, 49 champions, and we're just getting started. Learn more at charitychampions.org.
Oklahoma's defense got the stop it needed, and now it's up to the offense. They need some points. Venable's in a heated conversation with the officials.
Well, I think he's trying to explain to them on that punt return when a fair catch was called. His player got blocked into the guy receiving the football, and so that's what he's so upset about. And luckily for the defense, they were able to get the ball back, and there wasn't, you know, much bigger damage that came from it. But yeah, that's what I'm assuming he's most upset about there, is that why that was called a catcher interference call when his player seemingly got blocked into the returner.
How important is this drive for Oklahoma?
It's incredibly important. They have to, you know, impose their identity and their will on this drive to get back in this football game. And the defense has really taken over for the Baylor Bears.
Eric Gray up the middle to the 27-yard line. His 11th carry of the game. That puts him over 40 yards. He's coming off back-to-back 100-yard rushing games. Here he goes again with some space to wiggle and work to the 36. That moves the chains.
And when you move the chains in Jeff Lebby's offense, you go quick, you go tempo, you get the defense off kilter just enough, and then allow Dylan Gabriel to hit a big shot down the field.
They'll stick with Gray. Another nice pickup. Eric Gray rolling right now.
You know, I had Oklahoma a little earlier this year versus Kent State, and there was a struggle. There was a struggle in the first half. They probably should have been down 3-0. They got a quick score with Mims at the end, but there's some similarities here with that offense and what they need to get going, and that's the guy they need to get going with.
Mims, the completion, catches it, but two flags come out. Christian Morgan was in on the coverage for Baylor.
These conversations between the officials on these flags have been just, it's been a lot to them.
There's no foul for an ineligible receiver downfield. There's a personal foul, face mask, number 4, defense. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
And that is on number 4, Christian Morgan of Baylor.
Well, I think the discussion was whether or not Mims was behind the line of scrimmage, if that's what they were looking at. But of course, the face mask right there, the official who throws the flag, he's behind Mims, so he doesn't, and he can't tell that he's behind the line of scrimmage. That's why there's no penalty for linemen downfield.
Willis in motion. Fourth handoff of this drive, and it goes to Eric Gray. If it's working, go back to it.
Well, that's what I thought that needed to happen to start this drive. They needed to find an identity, and it certainly hasn't been Dylan Gabriel today, who's really been the answer for them offensively all year long. But Eric Gray, letting this offensive line kind of build some confidence, move around the defensive line for Baylor, kind of get the same feeling that offensive line for Baylor feels when they're up against this Oklahoma defensive line.
Marcus Major is in now. They'll let him try. Is there room on the edge? Down the sideline, you bet there is. That'll move the chains, too. They mark him inside the 10.
Great job of Marcus Major staying patient, following his block to the outside, and then a great block on the edge by Stoops to break him loose to pick up the first down and get inside the 10-yard line.
6 runs, 1 pass on this drive for Oklahoma. They've been a machine. Gray back in, Drake Stoops in motion. Gabriel will look his way. Look at the field in front of him. Back inside goes Drake Stoops into the end zone!
Oklahoma needed, had to have a response. And what did they do? They went to the ground. And here they get their favorite perimeter wide receiver. And Drake Stoops on that edge. He makes a guy miss and strolls into the end zone to bring this game to a 3-point deficit.
Seven plays, 77 yards. They get that touchdown.
Essentially a run play here to their wide receiver, Drake Stoops, and he lops into the end zone for 6.
Sooners as soon as the game's over to make sure you're taking care of it. Some big games, including in the Big Ten, Indiana. Penn State is rolling. That game is 24-7 in the third quarter. All right, here's one of the big ones. Georgia, Tennessee, and the Bulldogs having their way. Easy play in the back of the end zone. I say easy. Touchdown, Georgia. They're leading that game 24-6. Uh-oh. What's going on in Kansas?
The drive that Oklahoma needed. Seven plays, five of those on the ground, and they're able to send it in the end zone by Drake Stoops.
Big game. Bob stopped by here at the booth, watching his son again today just do a tremendous job for this Sooners program.
Second receiving touchdown of the game, and now Baylor, how do they respond? We've seen their response has been pretty good so far today when Oklahoma has scored. Look at the total yards, though. It's really interesting. Oklahoma almost 400 total yards, but remember, they've got the three interceptions they've thrown.
Those are the big, those determining factor in a lot of this, right? You turn the football over, you give another team that may not be generating the same kind of yardage opportunities. But I will say this, the identity of both these football programs today, it's been about running the football. Defining what they do up front offensively and defensively, and that's been the difference in this game.
And they both have exactly 168 rushing yards. Caught right on the sideline is Hal Presley.
Just as you say that, they asked Blake Chapin to do something that not many quarterbacks can do, and that's throw from almost their opposite hash on an out route for a completion when they've been running the ball so well. So, good play call by Jeff Grimes, like finding a way to go against tendency, and that was an easy pitch and catch.
13-yard pickup, and now they'll run it. Squirrel is dropped.
By Reggie Grimes.
Loss on the play. Reggie Grimes, and on the tackle.
Give me a little Dusty Dvorak vibes there with Reggie Grimes. Ooh. On the edge, ripping somebody to the ground.
Been interesting to watch the chess match. Remember, Baylor's offensive coordinator Jeff Grimes and then Oklahoma's defensive coordinator Ted Roof, they coached together at Auburn. They actually lived five houses down from each other, so they know each other pretty well. As Chapin in trouble just over the outstretched hand of Danny Stutzman.
Yeah, he got really lucky there, because when you go to throw that football away, you better have something on it. Good job of getting penetration and keeping him inside the pocket, making him retreat, and then Reggie Grimes makes him throw it away, and he barely gets enough on it to get it over the hand of the outreached arm of Stutzman.
Third down at the 38-yard line, Baylor's own 38-yard line. They're 2-for-8 on third down today. Flags. Some movement for Baylor.
False start. Number 65, offense. 5-yard penalty. Still third down.
That's a left guard, Micah Mazuka.
Mazuka could kind of see the guy coming off the slot receiver, coming to blitz, gave him a little anxiety. He jumps back a little bit, and now, once again, they're way behind the sticks, and you're in perfect situation for Oklahoma to rally and keep everything in front of them and get off the field.
They'll bring Quaylen Jones over next to Chapin. Nowhere to go for Blake Chapin. Look at Oklahoma's defense.
Absolutely no reason for Blake Chapin to leave the pocket there. He could have set his feet, looked down the field. Instead, he moves out on his own volition and has to throw it away. And once again, Oklahoma gets another stop, two in a row now.
Number one for Oklahoma is now wearing number 99. Number one is now 99.
It's a significant change, 1 to 99, by the way. That's 98.
It's about 98 numbers.
Yeah.
Isaac Power with the punt. And Oklahoma will call for the fair catch. Let's check in with Tori.
Courtney, at the beginning of every Baylor team meeting, Coach Aranda shows them a picture of a huge staircase going up a mountain. It's called the Stairway to Heaven. It is in Hawaii. That's where Aranda spent 4 years of his coaching career. He shows them this to say, hey, you've got to take things one step at a time. You can't look at the noise around you or what's ahead of you. Just look down at the very next step. He wants to get his team focused on the small things they can do rather than everything going on around them. Courtney?
And Tori, we've learned if you've ever talked to Coach Aranda, he's a big metaphor guy, very philosophical, lots of philosophy, very psychological with his players. Was a philosophy major in college. Eric Gray on the carry.
I would expect another heavy dose of Eric Gray on this drive, letting this offensive line cook, if you will. You know, instead of going backwards when you're pass protecting, when you can go forward and impose your will and be physical, that's what they're looking for.
Yeah, this was their bread and butter, running the football on that last drive that was so successful. Eric Gray has got it. Move the chains.
You know what's so impressive about the senior out of Memphis? His ability to keep his shoulders square at all times and then find that hole and explode through it to pick up first downs. He's never, ever going backwards.
They just keep handing it off to Gray, being productive every time. You know, he comes from a running back family. His dad, Eric, was a running back at Tennessee State. Also was Eric's running back coach in high school. His uncle, Maurice Hall, was a running back at Ohio State in the early 2000s, so it's in his blood. Gray started out at Tennessee before making the transfer over to become an Oklahoma Sooner. Willis in motion. Major gets the handoff. Bouncing around, bouncing forward to the 41-yard line. Stopped by Cole Maxwell.
Another good job by the offensive line of really nothing really being there, but using their ability to be physical and pushing people off the line of scrimmage allows Major to pick up a couple more and now sets up a very manageable third and three for Dylan Gabriel. I wouldn't be surprised if we see a bit of a play-action fake here. Maybe a run-pass option, or at least, you know, an option with the running back, and maybe Dylan Gabriel can do something with his feet.
He lets it fly to Gray. Got the first down just short of midfield.
You know, good job by Jeff Lebby in terms of what they're doing offensively and really kind of going like an accordion, running inside, and then putting a lot of pressure on the middle linebacker to cover Gray on the perimeter, and he can't get there as Gabriel's very accurate with the throw.
7-yard pickup. Gabriel on the move, dumps it off to Gray, makes the catch.
Dylan Doyle is tired. He's been chasing Eric Gray around for the last two plays, and that time he just kind of gave up on the play. He kind of stood there assuming the ball was going to go into the ground. Instead, Dylan Gabriel puts it right at the feet of Eric Gray, who makes the catch and picks up about 7 yards.
You can tell there's some major trust between Dylan Gabriel and Aaron Gray.
False start, number 9, offense. 5-yard penalty, still second down.
It's on the tight end, Braden Willis.
Pre-snap penalties are just absolute killers to momentumless drives. But you're right. You're right about Eric Gray. That's the 8th penalty today for 64 yards. He shifts a little bit while Drake Stoops is in motion. But you were right about the Eric Gray, Dylan Gabriel like relationship. There's a comfort and there's a confidence between the two.
Gives it to him again. I mean, the coaches have said numerous times, Eric Gray, he's the last one off the practice field. He's usually in the football facility by himself. He's there late. He's there early. Game means a lot to him. This team means a lot to him.
Well, it does to a lot of these players, right? I mean, it's been a lot of up and down this last offseason with the departure of Lincoln Riley, a new head coach, and all the changes and what the culture wants to be here.
To the 46-yard line, back to the, it'll be fourth down. Christian Morgan stops.
I mean, good job, but I honestly think that Jeff Lebby knew that they were probably going to go for it on fourth down when we start this fourth quarter.
And so we'll see. That's the end of the third quarter. One more quarter of football coming up between these two. Baylor leading Oklahoma 31-28, but fourth down coming up for the Oklahoma Sooners when we come back to Norman. Fourth quarter, Oklahoma will punt here. Do they save it? Yes! The extra effort on special teams for Oklahoma pins Baylor deep.
Yeah, this was the question. What do you do here? Do you utilize what Turk brings to the table? And that's exactly what they do. They pin him back inside the 2-yard line. Great play of not allowing that ball to cross the goal line.
The field is there was a touch of the ball while it was over the goal line playing. The result of the play is a touchback.
It's all about where the ball is.
Yeah, and it just takes that one kick forward, and as he gets it, it looks like he breaks that plane, and official was right there, could see it. Initially they had marked it at the 2, so they had a discussion about it, and not necessarily a backfire. Defense has been really good the last two series, so I think that's what Brent Venables wanted to do there. He didn't want to give any momentum to Baylor by getting a fourth down stop on turnovers, but now allow their defense to go out, who's had a really good effort the last two times they were on the field.
And Oklahoma's offense has looked really good, too, in the second half. Pass batted up into the air, but drops incomplete. Deshaun White got a hand on it.
Wonderful job of not being dissuaded by the play action. Goes up, uses both hands, and then Blake Japan does a good job there by knocking the ball down, because that could have been devastating if intercepted at that point.
Deshaun White plays that cheetah position for Oklahoma. He has the longest job list on the defense, and he has owned that role. They stick it with Squirrel. To the 26.
Been a bit surprised here in the second half after that initial drive that they haven't been more present with what they did in the running game, instead relying a little bit on Blake Shapen in the passing game, and that hasn't worked out. There they go right back to it, a little toss that picks up a few yards, but once again, they're in a situation where they have to convert on third down to keep it going, keep Dylan Gabriel in the offense that has found a bit of a rhythm off the field.
So now on third down at the Baylor 26.
Oklahoma takes their first charge timeout of the half. Media timeout.
And we'll step aside. Third and 4 coming up for Baylor. Woo! Oklahoma calls timeout before Baylor going for it here, obviously on 3rd and 4 coming up for Baylor.
Yeah, Jeff Grimes there in the middle of the huddle, really imploring his team to make a big play here. This is an important football play. They have not been able to execute their last two drives on the offensive side of the football. They need a conversion here on 3rd down to continue this drive.
Shapen has Squirrel Williams with him. Cuts back inside. Blake Shapen falling forward.
The spot at the top of the field looks like it is a first down, but the spot at the bottom of the field looks short.
And now there's an Oklahoma player down. Oh, it's David Ogwebu.
Ted Roof, when we talked to him yesterday, really talked about Ogwebu and how more comfortable he is in the system. And it's what's made him such a dominating force for this defense. His ability to chase from that middle linebacker position has been incredibly important, right? 68 tackles coming into this matchup.
And 72% of his tackles have been over the last 5 games, so he's getting better. This is going to be short for Baylor as Ogwebu is able to get up, but still favoring that left arm.
I think it's a pretty good spot. His knee looks like it goes down with the ball short of the 30-yard line. This is big. I mean, this is what Dave Aranda does. He goes for it on 4th down. He's aggressive. They have to go under center. A little sugar huddle here as Blake Shapen goes up to the line.
Squirrel Williams is the back.
Yeah, I think they're just going to try to get him to jump offside.
They're going. They give it to Squirrel. He's got it. Wow.
Wow.
Going for it at the 30. Their own 30.
I mean, that is a ton of confidence in your offensive line, knowing you can pick up 1 yard. Baylor 3 for 3 today on 4th down. Extends what they have been really, really good at this year, and that's executing in those situations. And biggest difference for me from what Oklahoma did earlier in the game, right, is they lined up in shotgun rather than under the center, and it just allowed. I didn't think they were going to run a play there, Courtney. That surprised me, and well done.
They convert 66% of the time on the season. This is Quaylen Jones to the 38-yard line, forced out of bounds by Danny Stutzman.
Good job of staying patient, parallel, and then putting his foot in the ground and finding a little hole, and uses his physicality. Shove around Stutzman a little bit as he steps out of bounds and has a nice 8-yard pickup.
Does that give the offense some juice when your coach trusts you on a big situation like that?
Oh,
fourth down?
Yeah, especially if you're an offensive lineman. You just feel like you can do anything in these moments.
Jones again. Moves the chains.
When we talk about those fourth down conversions, and when you said the 60% thing, it made me think of the Ron Burgundy line, where 60% of the time it works every time.
Yep. Hey, it's worked every time today for Dave Aranda.
It definitely has.
Shapen stepping back. Josh Cameron. Something's been working for those two today. Josh Cameron with another reception.
Yeah, to your point, they had to have seen something in film where they knew he could gain an advantage. And then it's the 4th time he's caught a ball today. He's only had 7 coming into this game. And I think he's been targeted those 4 times. I think he's 4 for 4 in terms of targets and completions. And
that's his 5th catch.
Wow.
72 receiving yards for Josh Cameron. He came into the game with 59 on the season.
He's been targeted 9 times today. I mean, there was something they saw in film all week where they knew they could take advantage in this game against the Sooners.
They'll go pistol look with Squirrel Williams behind Shapen. Squirrel's turn. Squirrel still on his feet. Did he get enough push to move it? I think he did.
You know what I found so impressive about both these teams today, Courtney, is no matter what, any moment when they needed a response, each team has responded in kind. This was exactly what Baylor needed in terms of response, and they've gotten it from right there with Squirrel, who now has, this team has rushed the ball 37 times today for over 200 yards now, 202 yards on the ground for the Baylor Bears.
That's right, at their game average, they average 201 yards a game on the ground. That's fourth in the Big 12, 22nd in the nation. OU defense missing a couple of players too. Jaden Davis, we haven't seen him return. Key Lawrence and Agwebu. They just give it to Squirrel and he just keeps the chains moving.
You know what's been so good about him today is in this rushing game and how they space everything out with the offensive line. His patience behind the line of scrimmage. Watch as his offensive linemen just move that zone and continue to push down the field. And Squirrel Williams just waits his time, you know, just waits it out until he can put his foot in the ground and explode and gets another first down to move the chains.
Yeah, if you're just joining us, Richard Reese had 36 carries last week for Baylor. Squirrel Williams returning this week. He has 21 carries. Reese only four today. Here's Jones. Out around the 10.
I mean, when you're a running back and an offensive lineman, when you hear that play call come in and you get told you're going to go for it on fourth and one, this drive here, 8 rushes, only 2 passes. They've just imposed their will, and both offensive lines have done that in this game when they needed to. And sometimes offensive coordinators get out of their head a little bit, but you got to get back to what you do best, and both these teams are doing that so far in the second half.
Chapin turns around and hands it off to Quaylen Jones. He's got room into the end zone. Quaylen Jones! That's his 6th rushing touchdown of the season.
The left side of this offensive line on this drive alone has just been epic in how they pushed the defensive line for the Sooners back on every single play. They've extended them. They made the holes widen, and then the running backs did a tremendous job of finding those and then exploding for big plays.
That was an 11-play, 80-yard drive. Took up 5 minutes and 35 seconds. 9 rushing plays, 2 passes.
Again, Connor Galvin, Micah, the bazooka lead the way as Baylor takes the lead.
Baylor extends its lead back to a 10-point game, 9 minutes, 15 seconds left. This is a big game for Baylor when it comes to the Big 12 standings. They're not out of the Big 12 hunt.
No, only two losses so far for the Baylor Bears. Of course, the three for Oklahoma puts it more of a dire need of a win today. But the response from both of these teams when opportunities were presented to them, you almost look back and you question whether or not Brent Venables should have went for it on fourth down rather than punting it. Instead, Dave Aranda does the complete opposite. It backed up, goes for it on fourth down. It allows them to go forward and get the touchdown and extends the lead to 10 points.
Let's check in with Tori.
Courtney, Coach Venables is getting pretty fired up down here on this Oklahoma sideline. I think we're seeing a little bit of that focused intensity he told us about this week. He's been getting in players' faces a little bit, talking them up. But he told us this week when he does that, he's never just yelling at a player. He's always talking them about details, about things he wants to see them do better. I think that's what we're seeing down here on this sideline.
Now the details, all the little things, they're magnified. 9 minutes and 15 seconds, so room to work. They can run the ball still, do you think, Ryan, here?
Definitely, with the amount of time, they can still run the football and get within one score, and then you have to deal with the clock and management and things of that nature.
It's been the difference in the second half. They've committed to the ground game as Dylan Gabriel scrambles and slides about the 27-yard line.
They look like they have a little, intensity to them and where they want to go, more up-tempo, because they know that time's a factor, especially being down 10. Ooh!
Eric Gray felt all of that by Dylan Doyle. I think he heard you say he was tired earlier.
He looked tired earlier. He didn't look tired there. He fills the hole better than anybody. Takes that running back to the ground, meets him perfectly with a form tackle to the ground.
Third and six, Oklahoma 8 for 13 on third down. Gabriel, time, connecting, pass complete. First down, the catch made by Braden Willis.
Good job by Dylan Gabriel, sitting in the pocket, waiting for his wide receiver, or more or less his tight end, Braden Willis, to break out. Off number two, Matt Jones, and he's able to get the ball thrown low, but he goes and gets it and gets the first down.
Ball's at the Oklahoma 36. Wow, all day for Gabriel. This is Eric Gray coming out of the backfield. He's a yard short of the first down, takes it to the 45 where Garmin Randolph met him.
Oklahoma's really decided they're going to throw the football here and kind of move away from rushing the football. Here we go. Eric Gray gets an opportunity.
But nowhere to go. It's a loss on the play. Dylan Doyle.
It's second and one. That was an opportunity right there to really take a shot, do something inventive. Instead, they try to just pick up the first down real quick, and Baylor's right there and ready to get him on the ground. And now they are in a position to try to pick up another third down.
But are you hesitant to take a shot with the three interceptions that Dylan Gabriel's thrown today?
I don't think so.
Drake Stoops. You hear the crowd, Stoops, first down.
Well, Drake Stoops has come up big today when they needed him in situational football. And right there, they just throw a quick screen out to Stoops on the edge. They have a good block by Farouk, who gets him enough to get the first down.
They fake it to Gray. Play action for Dylan Gabriel. Here's your shot. Farouk is there. Can't connect.
Some flags that come out from the back end that leads me to believe there's some possible holding in the back end. Let's hear what the official has to say.
Illegal substitution, more than 11 players on the field, defense. 5-yard penalty, first down.
It's counting them up there on the from the back judge. It's a good throw here, just overcooks it a bit for Farouk, who got behind Christian Morgan.
Major. To the 45-yard line of Baylor. Dylan Doyle. Obanaya there.
You have to be aware of the clock here, but it's not something that has to creep into your mind. You want to execute and you want to get points regardless of how many that is at this moment.
Marcus Major gets the call again. Should have the first down.
And he does.
Clock moving. Gabriel play action. Now he's got to move. Inside, I think he started the slide just before the line to gain. Second and a yard coming up.
Good job of using his feet once again. It's where they were tough to beat in that first quarter when he scored on a touchdown run.
Yeah, the very first drive. Here goes Gray. The first down inside the 25. Trying to break loose. Stopped at the 17.
What a great job making guys miss in space. If Marvin Mims gets this block on the perimeter, that would spring Eric Gray for the touchdown that would have brought it within 3 points. Mims just misses him coming in to get that block and clean it up.
Gabriel looking up top. He'll dump it out to Eric Gray.
I mean, this second half has really become the Eric Gray show. They've gone to him on the ground. They've gone to him in the air. And I would expect, as he trots off the field, for him to be a big part of their game plan moving forward if they want to get back in the sink.
Yeah, he had 9 carries in the first half, and now that total for the game is up to 22. Gabriel got it. Turn in the corner. Can't punch it in.
This time, Marvin Mims is there. He gets the block that springs Dylan Gabriel around the edge that puts him inside the 2-yard line. This is just a great pull and an option look. And he just gets to the perimeter, and Marvin Mims gets a big block on that perimeter to spring him out to the outside.
They put Stoops in motion. Eric Gray is the guy. Eric Gray. Touchdown.
Responsive football in the second half. It has kind of been that all game long. And it's a, you may look at what the season has been for both these teams. Here's just a straight hand up the middle for Eric Gray. He follows his linemen and gets into the end zone. And like I said, you know, you have plenty of time. 4 minutes left. You have all, I believe they only have 2 timeouts left, but that's plenty of time to get a stop and get the ball back, only being down 3.
You know, 2 timeouts for Oklahoma, 3 timeouts for Baylor. 4:05 on the clock as Zach Schmidt sends up the PAT, and now Oklahoma trailing by 3. Well, drama brewing. Oklahoma on the comeback thanks to Eric Gray. He's over 100 yards and 2 touchdowns today. Eric Gray gets his second rushing touchdown of the day, and Oklahoma is trailing by three. Defense ready to go back to work, and for Baylor, they just want to eat up as much of this clock as possible.
I mean, this will be the epitome of what situational football looks like in terms of the four-minute drill, where everybody in this stadium, everybody anywhere near Norman, everybody watching on Big 12 Now, ESPN Plus, Baylor's going to run the football. Can you stop them?
The phrase is pound the rock. They have run for 232 yards today. Squirrel Williams leading them with 141 yards on the ground.
Yeah, both teams have rushed the ball really well, but what Baylor has done best is converted turnovers with this rushing game, taken time off the clock, kept the ball out of the hands of Dylan Gabriel in that explosive offense. And Baylor's just been really good. Offensive line has been better than the defensive line for the Oklahoma Sooners all game long, and they're going to have to ask them to be the same on this drive. Utilize the last 4 minutes, pick up a few first downs, make Oklahoma burn those timeouts.
David Agwebu back on the field for Oklahoma's defense. That's big for the Sooners. And of course, they run it with Squirrel. Danny Stutzman in on the stop. These are the two featured backs in this game today. We thought it would be the freshman, Richard Reese, but it's been Squirrel Williams' day with 141 yards.
Yeah, he's done a tremendous job, 6.7 yards per carry. And Eric Gray on the other side, every time his number's been called, he's been up to the challenge as well. Both have two touchdowns. Good job by both coordinators knowing what they had and what they were going after.
Williams again. Met by three Oklahoma defenders. Picks up a yard on the play. Billy Bowman is there.
Great pursuit. Never fooled at all. The linebacker scraping across. They get out, square up Williams, get him to the ground, and now we have that third down, third and long here, third and six. Are they going to ask Blake Shapen to do something that he struggled with all game long, and that's throw the football? Or are they going to find a way to use their running game, which has been really dominant?
Here goes Shapen. He's flushed. Lets it fly. And the pass is complete to Hal Presley. Over the 40-yard line. Just the third time that Baylor has converted on third down today.
You know, when you're up here from the booth, Courtney, you can see the guy come open just as Blake Shapen starts to get outside the pocket. And I wanted to throw it. He lets it go right in the sunshine. And I think that may have gave him a little bit of problem. Presley catching the ball, but he gets it in that zone. Perfectly thrown, just a little too late by Bowman to get there, and they execute and get the conversion.
That's a 14-yard pickup. Ball's placed at the Baylor 43. Richard Reese. When do you start using timeouts if you're Oklahoma?
They just did right there. So you.
Second charge timeout of the half, Oklahoma.
We'll step aside. 2 minutes, 11 seconds.
Timeout. Media timeout. The clock operator.
Oklahoma has one timeout remaining. It's second down. Baylor with the ball on its own 46-yard line. The Bears trying to beat Oklahoma in back-to-back seasons for only the second time. The first, 2013-2014.
I expect them to run the ball here. Make Oklahoma use and burn that final timeout.
And they will with Williams. Right to midfield.
Another wonderful job by the offensive line of just moving people back off the ball, allowing Squirrel Williams to find a little bit of light to get it into a very manageable now third down for this football team.
And even if you don't get it on third down, Dave Aranda going to go for it on fourth down, you would think?
Well, with no more timeouts, yeah. I do think if he's willing to go for it, backed up like they were earlier, if they get the first down here, game is over. And so that's exactly what you want from your four-minute offense. We thought maybe you would take two first downs. That's exactly the position that they're in right now. It's a matter of whether they can do what they've been doing all second half or Oklahoma stiffens up and gets a stop. It comes down to the fact that, I mean, Oklahoma's dominated on the offensive side of the football in terms of yardage.
500 total yards.
Yeah, 500 yards of total offense so far. The turnovers have been the story in the first half. Second half, no turnovers. Right, there's been a better game back and forth, but the turnovers in the first half are what Brent Venables and this team are going to point to and the reason why they lost the football game, because it's been competitive, and it's been a lot like Oklahoma's season, right? It's been up and down. They've made some mistakes. They've made some great plays, yet they're in a very familiar situation this year and, you know, facing the fourth loss right in the face if they can't get a stop right here.
Blake Shapen goes under center. He has Williams behind him in the backfield. Neighbors in motion. It is Squirrel Williams. Oh my goodness, Squirrel!
Go down.
Got to smart. So smart, they need to burn the clock.
I always tell players when I'm talking to them about game and time management, the other team can't win if they never have the opportunity. And if you score there, you give Oklahoma a chance. Oklahoma will not see the football again, and they will win this football game. So very smart. That is Dave Aranda understanding, teaching his team. The offensive line was pure right there. If you want to look at how you block up a cutback zone run, take a look at that final play by the Baylor Bears.
Squirrel Williams has been fantastic today. 25 carries, 192 rushing yards. He had 209 rushing yards coming into the game on the season.
Yeah, he's been special. You heard Dave Aranda at halftime on the way out talk about him. I mean, you rarely hear a head coach talk about like the overall view, the peripheral of a player instead of what's going on in the game. He talked about what he's overcome and how he's gotten to the place and what a great game for him. A game that we didn't see coming. We assumed Richard Reese would get a ton of the play calls, but they've been really good with Squirrel Williams running the football.
He was injured in the 2019 season, the 2020 season. He's been banged up this year, but he has been the hero today, the workhorse for Dave Aranda's squad. And he's done it behind what has been a great offensive line today.
Oh, they've been so impressive. And that's the pound-the-rock mentality, right? Being able to do it up front. Look at Connor Galvin, Micah Mazuka, Jacob Gall, Grant Miller, and Gavin Byers. All five of them have really had a great football game. You rarely talk about an offensive line as a whole. This team came in here, gutted it out, and for only the second time, they get their second consecutive win over the Oklahoma Sooners, giving them their fourth on the season.
Baylor still in the hunt for that Big 12 championship. It's not totally out of reach. They came in, took care of business today. What a fun football game, though. Wow.
Yeah, I'm just really impressed with how they've bounced back. The two losses in conference, right, to at the loss on the road against BYU back when BYU was pretty much firing on all cylinders on the road in Utah there.
The loss to Oklahoma State and West Virginia.
Yeah, the West Virginia one. It was a good game played by Baylor.
Yeah.
It really was. They executed well. Blake Shapen had a good football game, but West Virginia at home at night in Morgantown. It's always a tough place to play, and they found a way to win it. They found a way to gut it out, and now Baylor's back in that same situation. They're going to keep presenting, but TCU looks good. We'll see what Kansas State does against the Texas Longhorns tonight. That will be a big one. Surprised that Texas is a favorite in Manhattan, but they are.
Yeah.
That surprised me a little bit because
who goes at quarterback too for Kansas State?
I don't think it matters.
Yep.
As long as you're wearing purple in the Big 12 this year, you're dominating, it looks like.
Baylor has K-State left, TCU, and then they'll play at Texas to close out the season.
Well, that's the thing I wanted to talk to you about. When we were looking at the schedule, talking to Dave Aranda, I said, this is the first of the gauntlet, right? I mean, if you get past Oklahoma, you have the likes of Kansas State, TCU, and Texas. All three teams are ranked currently in the college football playoff rankings.
What's the most promising thing you saw from Baylor today? Was it the run game and the offensive line?
Well, I think that all three phases. I think defensively, getting the turnovers, to do that, right?
Three interceptions when
they weren't as explosive. They were, when you talk about a bend but don't break defense, they bent their back a little bit, almost 500 yards of offense for Oklahoma, but the three turnovers are the deciding factor in this game ultimately. They are. And then the smarts. This team was more disciplined and just smarter down the stretch.
And Coach Aranda is standing by with Tori.
Thanks, Courtney. Coach, we talked this week about this team needing to shut out the noise. You came into a hostile environment and you won today. What did your team do right today?
I think we stayed together. I thought, this had a lot of West Virginia game in it. And in that West Virginia game, we broke. And full credit to West Virginia. But, feeling the onslaught from Oklahoma and just all their weapons and just the energy from the crowd and to not break and to find a way to win. To get an ugly win, it's impressive for us, and it's an area of growth for us. It's good to see.
Great day in the run game for you guys. What did you like about your running back and your offensive line play?
They wanted to finish forward. I thought our running backs ran violent. I thought they continued to try to push forward. I thought there was multiple hits at or near the line of scrimmage, and they wouldn't take that, and they continued to turn their legs and work forward. I thought O-linemen were coming off blocks and working to push the pile. And so all of that's kind of been a whole year in the making, and it's really good to see it when we need it most.
Thanks so much, Coach. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Baylor victorious, back-to-back wins over Oklahoma for just the second time in program history. They did it with their bread and butter, the run game, the offensive line, and their defense. Three interceptions for this Baylor defense. They come out and beat Oklahoma 38-35. Watch out, Big 12. Baylor's not going anywhere just yet. Bears next up. They'll face K-State next week on November 12th.